As outrageous and as groundbreaking as the original Saturday Night Live was, in many ways, SCTV was more obtuse.
Yeah.
It's wackier still,
right? It's wackier. Well, we had no sponsors. We had no networks, no one to tell us what to do. It was like being turned loose in a TV studio. And we never knew when the show would run, so we couldn't do topical material. So we were forced into the really dark parts of our imaginations, and that's what we did.
Tonight on Later, the many faces of Martin Short.
A very decent being on Later. Give me a break. I suppose it hasn't.
Tonight.
Thanks for staying up later. We continue from Los Angeles. Happy to have Martin Short with us. And the question is this, since we're on in late night.
Sure.
It really seems like a prescient choice, now that we look back, that Ed Grimley was so obsessed with Pat Sajak. Who would have known that Sajak was bound for such big things?
Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it? I don't think that anyone would. I didn't. You know, I never knew who Pat Sajak was when I first talked about as Ed Grimley's obsession with Pat Sajak. I just looked through TV Guide. I needed a game show host. And I thought that his name had a funny ring to it. And of course, then he became this legend. It was just before Wheel of Fortune became hot.
You'd never even seen Wheel of Fortune at
no.
that point?
No, I was writing this piece for Saturday Night Live for Ed Grimley because he was going to be excited about being on a game show. And it seemed like it was, the idea of the piece was about, you know, in America, how you can be like a loser, but then maybe tomorrow I'll be a winner. So it's difficult to always know whether you're... And a game show is the one thing that you can suddenly, you know, win a lot of money or go on a trip. So I wrote this piece about Ed Grimley auditioning for a game show. And I needed a game show. And I just looked through TV Guide and picked Wheel of Fortune because the Sajak was the spelling that attracted me.
And then after it clicked, that became an ongoing part of Grimley's persona.
Because Pat would be a decent guy, I would imagine.
So have you met Pat subsequently?
No, I've never met Pat.
That's amazing to me.
No.
I would have thought he would have sought you out.
One would think. No, he's been...
But that would be his first mistake, right?
No, he actually has. I just haven't done his show yet.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I had that thing to do. But I will.
One thing that Ed... whatever. One thing that Ed feared in going on the Wheel of Fortune, even if he won, there was a chance he'd be overcome by his own joy.
Yes.
Dissolve into a puddle.
Joy would be his new middle name, I must say.
When did it strike you that there was like a Grimley mania, that this was more than just a funny character? That people were walking around the way they were walking around a few years ago going, excuse me. They were walking around doing feeble imitations of Ed Grimley.
Doing Saturday Night Live, you were always aware of what character was being received well because there was a reaction when you did it again. So I think that I had done it once or something, and a couple of shows later I did Ed Grimley again, and suddenly there was this a reaction, so you kind of...
Yeah, the second Ed Grimley walked through the door and onto the set of a skit, people went berserk.
Yeah, it was great. It was the greatest kind of kick to get into it, because you were always kind of nervous and wondering if you were going to blow it and forget, you know, what you'd planned to do. But doing a character like that and starting a scene and suddenly it was... Everyone immediately liked you. You could barely not do well.
Where did this guy come from?
It was a combination of a few people I knew, you know, in high school. There was a guy I knew who used to just... he was into photography. And his voice went up. He'd say, you know, I took a lot of slides in the weekend. I hope that you would somehow find time so that you could see my slides that I took on the weekend. So there was that guy.
Usually has a pencil box that has all the state capitals on it. And
Yeah. And then there was another guy who
kind of talked like this, you know, kind of like talked like this. So I kind of combined the voices and suddenly it was like this, you know.
And I was doing it on the stage of Second City. And it was a scene called Sexist. It was about a guy who was auditioning for a job. And a girl was auditioning for a job. They were both auditioning for the same job, and there was one employer. And the employer was Peter Aykroyd,
mm-hmm.
Dan's brother, and this is in Second City, Toronto. And so I used to, like, slick the hair up a little bit in the front, and then he would say that, he said, boy, last night that hair was getting taller every night. So as a joke, I stuck it right up to make him laugh, and the audience laughed, And my instinct is, if they laugh, then you just don't change it, you know.
In my opinion, you might have a different favorite, but the single greatest one was when Howard Cosell showed up as what, Grimley's uncle or something, or his cousin?
Uncle Basil or something. And Howard was great. Howard
he was
funny.
Unbelievable.
Yeah. But, he, Howard had never seen the character, had no idea what it was about, and yeah, I'll do it. And so we did the dress rehearsal, and it went, you know, pretty well, and then they changed the audiences. You know, they'd have a dress rehearsal on Saturday night at 7:30, and the second one for the live audience. And we were having notes in between, and I said to Howard, Howard, I didn't really know Howard, but I said, Howard, because someone had told me his name was Howard. I said, Howard, it was great what you did, but, you know, tonight, you know what would be even better, Howard, is, it's Howard, right? I said, if you do the teeth, get your teeth like this, you know?
Yeah.
And he just stared at me, smoking a cigar, staring at me. And I just stared back at him. So we just stared for a while. And then Bob Tischer, the producer, said, well, anyway, I'm sure it's going to be a good show. So about 10 minutes later, I was in my dressing room, and my dressing room was beside the makeup room. And I heard Howard talking to Tischer saying, I'll do the scene, but I'm not doing the friggin' teeth, okay? And you don't have to do it, Howard. You don't have to do the teeth. The teeth are unimportant. But he got an unbelievable reaction without the teeth, anyway.
What do you think it is about Grimley, other than the absurdity of the character, that endears him to people? Not just makes people laugh, but makes them feel affectionately toward this preposterous character.
I don't know. I think it's, you know, he just has these observations of based on joy. He's like this adult who's never become jaded by life in any way. He's like a heart attack. Someone who's had a heart attack and they survive it, and they're just, you know, filled with... they're smelling the roses for the first time. He's like that. He just hasn't had the heart attack. So if the phone rings, every time the phone rings, he'll be excited. Oh, the phone. Isn't the phone decent? There's always such a sense of mystery. You know, which is true when you think of it.
Short people got no reason. Short people got no reason. Short people got no reason to live. They got
impressions as much as you create characters. They may be real people, but you don't do impressions the way David Fry used to do Nixon or Frank Gorshin did Kirk Douglas.
Yeah, well, no, I do some impressions. I do impressions and characters. I think the characters are probably more rewarding because they're more of a creation, but I've done some impressions in my day. SCTV, we used to do them.
But when you do Katharine Hepburn, sure, you're doing Hepburn's voice, but you're expanding on that and creating some sort of cosmic Katharine Hepburn.
Oh, I suppose. Well, I first, Nelson Hepburn, I would do, which was a second cousin of Katharine Hepburn, hot dog vendor in Central Park.
Yeah, and it's odd how one member of a family, no more distinguished than the other by breeding, would wind up a world-famous actress, and the other guy winds up a hot dog vendor.
Well, it's life. It's so much. You never know what's going to happen. Heaven's sake, but Nelson's proud of his life. You cut the wieners every day, make sure that they're pure. And then you close up on Saturdays. Sundays are a day of rest.
And there's a certain integrity to that.
I agree.
Now, I didn't know until you let me in on it that Jerry Lewis had a niece, Denise.
Oh, yeah. Denise Lewis, works in a doctor's office, Dr. Harry Goldman, and is a super. She would like, she would get a call, and she'd say, "Yes, hello, Dr. Goldman's office. You would like the doctor? I'll see if he's in. Hold on, please. Dr. Goldman!"
Yeah. Get that intercom. Not for Denise.
You know, it strikes me that with public figures increasingly in trouble, Oliver North, John Tower, Jim Wright, they could all use the services of Nathan Thurm, couldn't they?
I know that. Now, Nathan Thurm is actually a character that is very hard to do spontaneously because it's all written rhythms.
And the cigarette is essential.
Well, Nathan Thurm was always like those, just those liars. You see, you know, Nixon, you know, the former president shoots to mind. There are others, but you know that kind of great glycerin on the upper lip, and the total denial of just saying, you know, according to our records, your client is was there. No, he wasn't. Well, we have, you think he was? It's so funny that you would think he was there when he wasn't there. That's so sad in a way. Oh, we have a picture. I know.
and then the ultimate.
Complete reversal.
The ultimate reversal would be, I have here, Mr. Thurm, a picture of you and your client with goats, and clearly you're receiving a check that is bribery money, and then Nathan Thurm would say, well, why don't you talk about all the things you've done wrong in your own life?
Right. Well, he's cornered. Well, first you'd say, no, you don't. And you'd say, yes, you do. No, I don't. Well, you think I
have it right here.
No,
here it is.
No, you don't.
Yeah, what do you think this is, then? If that isn't a picture of you with a goat, then what is it?
It's a picture of me. Why wouldn't I know it's a picture of me?
All right, so you concede that it's a picture of you.
Can you believe how boring he is?
You concede that it's a picture of you.
I know that.
All right, and it's a picture of you doing something criminal.
No, it isn't.
Yes, it is.
I
clearly
know.
It is. According to every statute, it is. Now, when Jackie Rogers Jr.
Yes.
springs from your head, where'd the seed come from? Who put the seed in there?
I don't know. Jackie is everything that is kind of disgusting in show business. He's the most narcissistic, silliest character I do. I mean, he's the kind of guy that, you know, in a show I did a couple years ago where he fell out a window, and actually fell out of a four-story window, smashed through the roof of a lion's cage, and fell into a cage with a lion, although he didn't know it right away, but was so absorbed in himself that the first thing he said was, gee, I never realized what tiny hands I have. So it kind of sums up Jackie.
When you left Saturday Night Live after just 1 year, did you ever look back? Or was that something
yes,
that you said to you?
I'm out. I made it. Oh, God, thank you, Mama.
Was it a deal where when you came in you said, 1 year, no matter how good, no matter what happens, 1 year is it?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Why did you confine yourself to just that? What was your thinking?
Oh, I had known the other casts, you know, and was well aware of what that show, the stress of that show, and the pressure of that show. And I had done 4 years of, or 3 years of SCTV. And so I to me, what was interesting about Saturday Night Live was it was a different kind of show, but it's an all-consuming show, especially if you're writing your own material. You're every waking hour, mine was anyway. I mean, maybe I did it all wrong. Maybe there's an easier way to do it. For me, I didn't know an easy way to do it. I had to be there all the time, and by the end of the season, you're saying it's like climbing Mount Everest. You say, that's great, but who wants to climb again? You know, I think I'll pass.
The HBO special airs when?
June 3rd, Saturday.
Now, did you do it as a production kind of thing where you did separate scenes and put them together, or is this in front of a live audience?
No, it's separate scenes. It's called I, Martin Short Goes Hollywood. And the idea is just, it's really about the, you know, that perception of that you can't do art in Hollywood. It's the antithesis of the Woody Allen perception. That you can only do art in New York, and it's a satiric look at Hollywood.
A lot of good people on that special with you too, right?
Yes, some great Christopher Guest and Tracy Ullman and Joe Flaherty and Dave Thomas and who am I now? Now they're Catherine O'Hara.
Do you see the full range of Martin Short characters?
You see quite a few characters in this, yes.
Yeah.
There's some new ones.
Who are some of the new ones? Or would that be giving it away?
Yes, it would be giving it away, and this is who you'll see. No, you'll see Dale O'Day, who's a wonderful dancer from the 40s. He's kind of like a Jack Haley Sr. type.
You know, he has a little Paul Shaffer in his voice.
Now Paul's more nasal, like that.
Yeah, he is a little. Yeah, I guess.
Dale is just like that, I suppose. If I only had a heart, you know?
So many of the people who became icons in American comedy came out of Canada in the last generation. Is there a difference in the Canadian sense of humor, generally?
No, I think it's sometimes easier for Canadians to observe more because we're sitting in an interesting position. We grow up with the BBC, we grow up with CBC in Canada, and we grow up with NBC, ABC, and CBS. And so we're really observing all these, we're like the middle sister, you know, of these three countries. So we observe a great deal. Also, they tend not to get to us right away, you know. We're, as Canadian actors, we're working, you know, doing lots of different things, learning a lot of just being in front of the camera, while not becoming stars, per se. And then by the time they're saying, gee, maybe we should fly up to Toronto and see what they have up there. Well, we've done enough that we have a little bit more experience, and suddenly they say, wow, there's a whole untapped oil well here, which was basically SCTV.
Do you think that there's some kind of general sort of life experience that's more likely to give rise to a comedian? Like, is it likely that somebody who grows up in a privileged environment and is at the polo club will become a comic?
You know, I don't know. I grew up in a kind of privileged way, and I don't think that it was harder for me to see things comedically. You know, I don't think you have to grow up in a poor area of Philadelphia to become a comedian. You know, I think you can. I think that comedy is something that is just you. In my family, everyone was funny, and comedy was the way of life. It was like the trickle-down theory, mm-hmm. comedically. You know, and I was the youngest of five, and you were just, you know, it was just the norm was to do jokes and be light about things, you know, and then you take that in your life.
Beginning Saturday, June 3rd, and running throughout the month of June, the HBO special starring Martin Short, Martin Short, Goes Hollywood.
Yeah, that's a pretty neat ring, Bob. It's Bob, right?
It is Bob. You've mastered that after half an hour. How would Ed Grimley say goodnight? We're at the see you later portion.
He'd say it's been very decent being on later. Give me a break. I suppose it hasn't.
Bob's guest tomorrow will be funny man Paul Rodriguez. Accommodations furnished by the Sheraton Universal Hotel, the official hotel of Universal Studios. On your next visit to Hollywood, visit Sheraton Universal Hotel, home of the stars.
Later tonight, Harold Ramis and the Ghostbusters are back in business. And if you watch all the clips on all the talk shows, you won't have to see the movie.
See you later.
Thanks for staying up later. I'm Bob Costas. This is Harold Ramis, and if the credits are necessary, he has either appeared in or written Animal House and Caddyshack and Stripes and Meatballs and Ghostbusters 1 and soon to be Ghostbusters 2. Safe to say, though, that a lot of people approach you on the street and say, with Bill Murray and with Aykroyd and with Belushi.
Yeah.
Does it drive you crazy?
When people ask for my autograph, and I
could sign anything you want.
Right, I give them a test. I say, what's my name before I sign. If they don't know my name, they don't get an autograph.
Somebody referred to you as the Clark Kent of comedy.
That was me.
Oh, that was you. I knew it was somebody. It was right on the tip of my tongue.
No, I think, it was the LA Times said that once. I spread it around myself.
Is it apt?
I like to think so. It's the other guys that, you know, take the big bows. I, you know, Someone asked me if I was a class clown once. I said no, but I wrote for the class clown. And I was, I always felt that, you know, I was the instigator, the guy who had the evil suggestions, you know, and that someone else was dumb enough to go out and do, you know.
Do you want to be a movie star, or doesn't it matter?
Yeah, I always treated acting like a hobby. When I saw the potential for humiliation in it and the constant rejection and the embarrassment of auditioning for people you may not respect for material you don't even like, I thought it's a great way to make a living, but obviously actors spend most of their time not acting. They spend their time looking for work. So when I saw it was easy to get work as a writer and then later as a director, I thought, why knock my brains out trying to be an actor? I thought it'll be my hobby, and I'll take work that I'm offered, then I'll never have to look for work, and, you know, every couple of years someone offers me something decent, you know, mainly people I've written for. So Stripes came along, and I got to be a small movie star, and then Ghostbusters, and a couple other things.
Would you be easy to direct? Suppose you had to direct yourself, could you do it?
Probably not. I wrote a little piece for Premiere Magazine about being a hyphenate, so-called hyphenate, writer, actor, director, and I admire people who direct themselves, but in the piece I said it was, for me, might not be a good idea, and I referred to Oedipus Rex, that he would have been better off being his Jocasta's mother or son, but not, or husband or son, but not both, you know?
So, right.
For
but
me, it's
mother
like,
or son, though, would have been an interesting twist.
That's a tricky one.
That
yeah.
would have further complicated an already sticky situation.
Yeah. No, I can't see it. I'm not that sure of myself as an actor that I'd want to risk ruining my own film as a director. You know?
Sidney Pollack told me that in the scene that he played in Tootsie, he was fine as long as it was a close-up of him. But when they were in a master shot, he couldn't take his eyes off what everybody else was doing, couldn't stop thinking, well, what's the relationship here? Because his primary mindset was as a director, and then he was completely screwed up trying to act.
Yeah, I don't think I could do it. I like directing, and I've I use my acting skills when I'm directing to inspire and enlighten the other actors. Usually by imitating them. That's where it really comes in. When I'm directing Chevy, I do Chevy for Chevy. And same with Rodney Dangerfield or with Bill, you know, anybody.
What's the best idea you ever had for a scene in a movie, and it just didn't work in that movie, it would have been too much of a detour, and it's still rattling around in your head, and you might have to do a whole movie just because this 5 minutes is so great?
No, I don't have any of those. I use everything. Really, I've had to. Every good idea, every bad idea I've ever had, it's been used somewhere.
You go back to the Second City days with people like Belushi and Gilda.
Yeah, well, I started at Second City in 1969 with Brian Doyle Murray, Bill's older brother, Joe Flaherty, who people probably saw in Second City television a lot, and some other people that they wouldn't recognize. And then I guess around 71, John Belushi joined the company. In 74, there was 73, 74, there was an exchange with the Canadian Second City. Gilda came down to Chicago. And then John got us all together to do a National Lampoon show. And that show was Brian Murray, Bill Murray, Gilda, me, and Joe Flaherty. And we all went to work for the Lampoon in New York. They all went on to Saturday Night, and some of us went to Second City television and then into movies.
Chevy Chase told me that Belushi was only half as good as he had been at SCTV by the time he got to Saturday Night Live, that he'd already begun to burn out.
At Second City? Yeah, well, John was, I guess, 20 when I met him, and very healthy. He was lean, believe it or not. And he had tremendous energy. He could do a backflip, you know, and then subsequently, if you watched his career, this was just indicative of, you know, how he was deteriorating and abusing himself physically. I mean, eventually the backflip turned into a flip where he actually ended up on his back instead of ending up on his feet.
And rolling around like a cockroach that's been turned over.
Right. So he just, and he got tired of it. He was
feeling burned out. Well, maybe a turtle on its back would have been a kinder description.
Yeah. But he was very cute at Second City. Audiences would, he'd get what we called mystery laughs. As soon as he'd walk out on stage, the audience would laugh for no reason. He didn't say anything or do anything. They just, he had such a funny presence that he always had that working for him.
Was it more than just a physical deterioration, though, by the time Saturday Night Live started? Had his mental acuity declined?
I think he got lazier. I think he was just tired. John expended more energy than anyone I ever saw. And so it just took a lot to get him moving, you know. And I think he was maybe a little tired of the lifestyle he was leading, but didn't know how to get out of it.
What was Gilda like in the early stages before she became a household name?
Gilda was, she's full of love. She really genuinely loved all the guys in the show. She was the only girl in the show, which was different from Second City. Usually there'd be two girls.
Mm-hmm.
So she got all our attention, and she made us all feel like we were her brothers, and we sort of protected her in that sense, you know. But she was also, she would do anything. There's another girl who would do just about anything on stage. And she and John used to do improv sometimes, which were usually about him abusing her in some sense. They did a scene that ended up in our Lampoon show in New York, which was she played a blind Mary Tyler Moore character, and John was her date, who took advantage of the fact that she was blind in lots of obscene ways.
Much as Ted Baxter might have if if the inspiration had struck.
So once they did an improv called Cowboy and Sailor. Don't ask me why. But John was the cowboy, Gilda was the sailor, but most of the scene was just him smacking her around a lot.
As outrageous and as groundbreaking as the original Saturday Night Live was, in many ways, SCTV was more obtuse.
Yeah.
Wackier still,
it's
right?
It's wackier. Well, we had no sponsors. We had no networks, no one to tell us what to do. It was like being turned loose in a TV studio. And we never knew when the show would run, so we couldn't do topical material. So we were forced into the really dark parts of our imaginations, and that's what we did.
What are some particularly fond memories from that?
Oh, that
really
show?
Perverse stuff is what I'm looking for.
With really sick stuff. Well, I think of Andrea Martin and Catherine O'Hara, the two women on the show, as the bravest, boldest actresses I know. They would do anything. We used to measure how good a woman was at Second City by how well they could take a punch, you know.
That's pretty much the mark of a quality woman.
Yeah, right. And those two, they would do anything. We did things. We got letters, Anti-Defamation League blackballed our show. Catholic organizations were down on our show. I remember Catherine did a piece as a Catholic nun flagellating herself as an exercise program.
And I'm really surprised that you got any negative feedback off of that.
Yeah.
I would have thought that would sail through untouched.
Yeah. We did a Passover Seder scene that's the one that got the Anti-Defamation League going. I'm speaking as a Jewish person, this was not favorable to Jewish cultural life. Where Eugene Levy played a character, Sid Dithers. He was the largest manufacturer of shoelace nibs in North America.
The shoelace nibs are the little things at the end
actually called aglets. Yeah.
Well, that's probably a lucrative field if you can corner the market.
Yeah, he had it. But just strange religious things, and I don't know, Joe Flaherty. Everyone had obsessions that they would keep milking in the show. Joe Flaherty would do news items about another earthquake in Togo. You know, poor Togo was always racked by earthquakes for some reason. I don't know. But there was no one ever to come in and say, no, you can't do that. Or, no, stop, that's insane or that's stupid. And we kept doing the show that way.
Did you regret not going to Saturday Night Live in the first year?
Well, you know, at first I felt sort of, hey, you know, why not me to be in the cast? And then in the second season, Lorne Michaels asked me to write on the show, but I was already pretty well ensconced at Second City and didn't want to jump shows. I thought that'd be disloyal. And we had Animal House going as a script, and I didn't think my future was going to be in television anyway. And I'd just done, like, 7 years of sketch comedy anyway on the stage, so I was pretty much done with sketch comedy.
Just for the sake of the fantasy, if you had been thrown in with the original Saturday Night Live bunch, what sort of characters could you have played? What sort of guy could they have gone to you for?
Me,
that would have been a different note than what they already had.
Garrett Morris's best friend, probably. That was a pretty strong company. I knew because when I met John Belushi, I'd taken a sabbatical from Second City on the stage. I went to Europe for a year. And while I was gone, I got a letter from Joe Flaherty saying that I'd been replaced by a little Albanian guy. And I couldn't imagine what he was talking about. And at everyone, because it's improvisational and you design your own material, everyone sort of finds a place on the stage and a range of characters that they play. And I'd always played long-haired, freaked-out zanies. And I had a place on stage, you know, about 11 o'clock upstage, which was my sort of power spot on the stage. And when I came back to Second City, I came out to make an entrance from the wings, and there's John Belushi standing in my spot, you know, with long hair, freaked out, playing all the zanies. So in a way, he just sort of, he really took my place in that respect, and I sort of fell more into the professorial roles that I started doing after that.
In fact, they used to call you the professor. Right?
Whenever we do an improv that had a gang, you know, we did a lot of gangs, you know, pulling off capers. I was always Doc, the professor, or Specs. You know, that was the role I always had.
Okay, now, to illustrate your obtuse sense of humor, let me throw out a movie and you tell me what your personal favorite scene in that movie might be. It might not have been what made the audience laugh the most. Animal House.
Oh, gee. Animal House, I guess, shooting the horse was a good scene. And then they cut to the dismembering the horse with a chainsaw. This is like high comedy. No, but everything we did in that movie was based on real college lore. And this, the unbelievable stunt of shooting a farmyard animal upstairs in a building, leading it upstairs, shooting it, and then it gets too stiff to get out through a door. So this was Doug Kenny and Chris Miller, my co-writers, you know, the depths of sickness that came out of that collaboration.
Miller used to write some incredibly twisted stuff in the National Lampoon.
Yeah, his, well, things that he wanted to put in Animal House were just... studio was terrified. I mean, it just, and they were all from real life too. The movie was a toned down version of real life. Most people thought it was outrageous, but it was mild.
Meatballs.
Oh, favorite scenes in Meatballs. I like Bill's relationship with the kid. Meatballs is a tough one for me. That was really a doctor job. I did 3 weeks work on that film, and so it's not my favorite film. I can't.
All right,
you
so
know,
let's
refer
go to Caddyshack.
To favorite things. Caddyshack, I love Bill's Dalai Lama speech. He's talking to a young caddy about the time he caddied for the Dalai Lama in the Himalayas. I love him caddying for Henry Wilcox and the old bishop in a thunderstorm. Mm-hmm. Rain is pouring down. We're using like 6 rainbirds and, you know, wind machines. And Bill's saying, I'd keep playing. I don't think the heavy stuff's going to come down for quite some time. And... there's a lot of good stuff in there. And Bill, another Bill thing, cutting the heads off flowers with a grass whip, pretending he's in the Masters, and talking to himself.
How about Stripes?
Stripes, geez, a lot of good stuff in Stripes. I like Bill's speech to rally us when he talks about that we're Americans. You know, we've been kicking ass for 200 years, we're 10-1, he said.
And, Vietnam, the only blemish on the record, but still leading the league.
Yeah, he says we're mutts, you know. How many saw Old Yeller? That, we call it the Old Yeller speech. There's just...
When he had PJ Souls on the griddle.
Yeah, you like that.
I liked it. He was kind of moving her around with a spatula from burner to burner.
Yeah, there's a lot of improv in that film. So some of the scenes... when I watch movies that I've worked on, I'm just amazed at how much of it was discovered on the set, and how insane we were to take that chance to go in with, you know, half-finished material and then finish it as we were shooting it.
Do you think that people who are pretty bright, pretty well-educated, have even more of an affinity for sophomoric slapstick stuff than others do? I find you get a bunch of guys together from Harvard, and they probably like the Three Stooges.
Yeah, no, I think that's true. Critics don't, because they're not allowed to like dumb comedy. And the more distinguished the publication, the less they're allowed to like it. Vincent Canby is always trashing the films we do in the New York Times. But there's a subtle difference, which a friend of mine once pointed out, between goofy and stupid. And there's a lot of broad comedy that's really dumb. I mean, just too dumb for me. I can't watch it. It assumes nothing on the. It assumes the audience are idiots. The characters in the film are idiots. I like to think that we do broad comedy that's goofy, and our characters are smart. We were told at Second City, always play from the top of your intelligence. So it's sort of a rule that I've always followed. Even if you're playing an idiot, the idiot can know a lot of things. So we try to use what we know. Bill's character in Caddyshack's a good example. This guy's obviously really off in some sense. He's disturbed, probably brain damaged. But he's tremendously clever and verbal. So
you want a guy with no common sense but a wide frame of reference.
Right, that's good. That's my ideal. I think our films are not dumb. You know, they're broad. And they're crazy, but they're not necessarily dumb. So.
Where do we pick up with Ghostbusters 2?
We pick up 5 years later, as in real life, and we're actually down and out, the Ghostbusters. We ended up paying the price for destroying that nice building on Central Park West, and Billy is doing a late night TV show. A cable access show called World of the Psychic. Aykroyd has a bookstore called Ray's Occult Books, and he moonlights doing Ghostbuster-themed birthday parties for kids. And I'm back teaching at Columbia doing research. We played with every permutation of it. You know, we had a draft where we were very successful. We had a high-rise office building, the Ghostbusters Incorporated, a worldwide franchise. We had one where a draft that picked up the literally at the end of the first movie as we were driving away. And then we thought, well, let's give us something to fight against, you know, give us a goal, you know, getting back in business. In fact, in this movie, we're under a judicial restraining order not to perform services as paranormal eliminators.
Sigourney Weaver show up in this?
Sigourney's in it. In the time between the first movie and the second, her character and Bill's character had an unsuccessful relationship. They broke up, she married someone else, had a kid, got divorced, and now he comes back into her life.
So there's a real integrity to this. I mean, these people's lives are traced. They're not just thrown back together willy-nilly.
No, that was actually a good move for us from a writing standpoint, bringing her back in as a former love interest of his.
Can a sequel to a movie that successful be as good?
Be as good as the first one? It'll definitely be better than Police Academy 6, I promise you.
Well, as long as you set your standards high, I think we're all reassured.
I don't know. Some people said the script was better. That's having written both, you know, I don't know. I have no objectivity about it. And I think the movie is great. I guess people will like it a lot. You know, it's hard to believe they liked the first one as much as they did. So, I'd rather underestimate the, you know, how well this one will do than just promise everyone it's going to be the best thing they ever saw.
We haven't mentioned Dan Aykroyd's name, and we really should, because he co-wrote the screenplay with you.
Yeah, let's mention it twice. Dan Aykroyd. We wrote both Ghostbusters together. It's his original conception. Came up with the idea of ghost exterminators in New York. As soon as I heard that, I thought this is something I really want to do. And so I've spent, you know, a couple of years with Dan hammering this stuff out.
Harold Ramis, slightly off-center, and we're all the better for it, and we'll see you later.
Join Bob Monday night when his guest will be rocker Robert Palmer.
Accommodations furnished by the Sheraton Universal Hotel, the official hotel of Universal Studios. On your next visit to Hollywood, visit Sheraton Universal Hotel, the home of the stars.
Later, the many faces of John Candy.
They paid me for that, too. See you later.
Thanks for staying up later. I'm Bob Costas, and this week in theaters everywhere, it's John Candy opening up as Uncle Buck, which we'll come back to in a minute, but let's work on the assumption that most people watching this, unless they got out there yesterday,
yes,
haven't seen Uncle Buck yet. So let's go to a recent one that many of our audience has seen.
All right,
Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, which has two or three of the funniest scenes you could ever want to latch on to.
We laughed a lot in that. Another John Hughes picture, by the way. We had a great time making that. We traveled a lot.
How much of it was ad-libbed?
Good portion of it. You know, there was a really solid blueprint script that John had that was very funny, and if we just shot that, it would suffice anybody. But John loves to just, let's push it one more, let's see what else we can get, let's find a line here or there. We found that out the first week, the first couple of days of shooting. You know, Steve and I would finish the scene, and we'd be looking at each other, we'd still be in character, and we wouldn't hear cut. And his eyes kind of flashed just a little, and you realize he's not going to cut. Yeah, oh God. So then you stay in character and you go, well, what about this? And he's just behind, you know, he's laughing back there.
The scene where the two of you wake up, you're in the same bed, and this is Steve Martin's worst nightmare, that not only does he have to share a room with you, but there's only a single bed, and now the two of you greet dawn's early light together.
To the music of Patsy Cline back in baby's arms. Oh, God. Well, as soon as that music came on, we started laughing. That was, you know, that was about an hour and a half before we could do it again. Because every time we got in that position, we'd start laughing. And we'd hear the music, we'd start laughing. Then we'd settle down and we'd see the camera start shaking. And everybody lost it. And then John said, well, you got to get closer to him. You got to nuzzle his ear. Kiss him in the ear. No, I'm not going to kiss him in the ear. You kiss him in the ear.
How bad does it annoy an actor who's doing a comic thing like that, when you have to do take four or five, and you know the most inspired thing happened, the first time something really spontaneous happened,
yeah,
and you're going to keep it, but now the other guy's going to hear it for the fourth time or the fifth time, so his reaction's not going to be original, but the first one had to be junk because the blocking wasn't right,
yeah,
or something,
yeah,
went wrong.
Yeah. That's tough. That's always very hard to do, to keep the spontaneity going, especially if you find that one line or something in there that you take after take after take, and to keep it fresh, but I guess that's, you know, that's what we have to do.
Yeah.
that's the job.
Another scene I think about whenever I see you on television or wherever is the racquetball scene.
Yes.
And Splash.
It was another inspired day, I'll tell you. Three takes on that.
Just three takes
three
to get that one
to
right?
Three takes to get on the head. We left early that day. The crew applauded me.
There you are, and you're really a fitness buff with a cigarette,
yes,
dangling from your lips.
Yes, a can of beer. He's been he had a rough night the night before, and he's playing racquetball with his brother, played by Tom Hanks. He doesn't really want to be there. He joined this great club, I think, because of the bar and probably meeting the girls there to check out the babes playing racquetball or to sneak around their locker room. But I served off the wall, and it came back, and I didn't realize just how fast those balls move.
Yeah.
and they hurt, too. But I had this great smile on my face, which you can never see, but then it hit. I was so excited. Then in a split second, I realized I had to fall, otherwise we're going to have to do this again. So I took the hit, and I smiled and dove down. That was the hardest part, was the diving down, because there was no stopping.
How bad did it really hurt?
It hurt. It was a good one, but, it was worth it. The moments like that, they're worth it.
How difficult is it to read reviews or to sit in the audience and hear reactions, and the reaction and the reviews are pretty much the same? We like John Candy. We don't necessarily like the film.
Yeah.
Is it kind of like a guy who goes 4-for-4, but his team loses?
Uh-huh. That happens. Yeah, that, you feel terrible about it because you really want the movie to succeed. You know, you don't take them just... Well, you know, I'll get paid for it, and that's great. I don't care about the rest of it, you know, as long as I look good in it. That's, you know, that's ridiculous. That's not me, anyway. There's a lot of people like that, I'm sure. But, as I say, you know, if you're not involved with the assembly of putting the picture together, and even that, even beyond that, the marketing of the picture, which these days is just, that's as important as the script.
Mm-hmm.
It's how they sell it. I mean, look at this summer with Batman, Ghostbusters. The campaigns that have come out is just, they're to be applauded, the way they're opening pictures these days.
Speaking of Ghostbusters, you could have been in the first one, right? You could have had the Rick Moranis role.
Yeah, how'd you know that? Yeah.
Pretty much, what, were they just typecasting by body type or what?
I don't know what the heck it was. It was, we were, Harold had called, and things just didn't go well. In the negotiations on it. And we didn't see eye to eye on certain things. And the rest was history, but Rick did a great job with it.
Let's go to another Ramis vehicle with Bill Murray, which is Stripes, and we'll end this opening segment on that one, because you couldn't have had many bad feelings about that, either your role in it or the thing overall.
No, I had a great time in that one. That was just a lot of fun to do.
I guess the scene that most people would remember of yours would be the mud wrestling scene where you finally decide your patriotic fever has been raised by a pep talk from Bill Murray, and you decide you'll do it.
I had to do it for the team, absolutely, for the core. For me.
Speaking of takes, I mean, I'm hoping you got that on the first or second take, because we'd want to roll around the
mud all
day.
Unfortunately, no. That took a lot of... Ooh, that took an extra week of shooting. For some reason, I just kind of blanked. I couldn't get a line out there. And every time we had to do it, and it got boring, too, believe me. You know, you'd have to just get in there with six girls, wrestle them, and then, you know, the take didn't work, so you'd have to go take a shower with them. And then, you know, the first two times, I'll admit it was fun. But then, the sixth, seventh time, I'll scrub my back. Okay, come on, let's just go on. Let's hurry up and let's get this over with today.
Oh, what a drag.
It was tough. They paid me for that, too. I know a guy who's tough but sweet. He's so fine, he can't be beat. He's got everything that I desire. He sets the summer sun on fire. I want candy. I want candy.
Later continues in a moment.
Back with John Candy. The days of SCTV.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about stuff that I guess it still lives. I was going to say it'll live forever. It lives
it's
now.
Living now on Nickelodeon, yeah.
Yeah. The Schmengies. The Schmengies were my favorites. Johnny LaRue was great and William B., but the Schmengies.
They were the best. We had so much fun doing them. Gene Levy and I found those characters. Of course, there was a derogatory remark. It was Schmegegi, I guess. I don't know if we can say that. But
Yiddish word.
A Yiddish word. And we would...
what would be the exact definition of Schmegegi?
I don't want to know. I don't think right now. We call a lot of people Schmegegis. But Schmegi came from that. It was actually from a friend of mine in Los Angeles, Stephen Young, who called everybody a Schmegi. And I picked it up, and then I brought it into the group, and everybody was a Schmegi. And if you did this, you were a Schmegi. If you did that, you were a Schmegi. We were in Edmonton in a hotel room, and we were watching a polka show. There wasn't a lot on TV that night. And we were working on a scene, and we watched these two guys in a polka show, a local show. And we went, look at those two schmangies. There's big light bulbs went, and yes. And we wrote it real quick. We shelved it. We didn't shoot it for 6 months. We brought it back. We forgot because we shot back in Toronto again the next season. And we forgot about the scene. We brought it in and said, yes, this was good. And we took it, we started getting the characters all made up and place the warts in the right spot and get the gold tooth and who's going to be what. And Gene, you know, I said, we have to be blonde. So Gene had to go for the wig. And I went with that tight wave.
Yeah.
You could
good
surf
look.
On my head, you know?
Kind of like a wrestler's wave.
Yeah. It's a bad do. A real bad do. And, clarinet and accordion, because I played a clarinet in high school. Gene played accordion, so we could fake that.
So there were the Schmengies.
There were the Schmengies. We came on, and the extras we hired a lot of elderly folk in there to be our extras for the polka party that the Schmengies were having. And everyone just fell in love with them. As soon as we came out in the characters, we knew we had something with
Yash
those characters.
Yash and Stan.
Yash and Stan. We did the salute to John Williams.
That was the cheapest.
The thing about the Schmengies
is... shark's head over my head.
It came from Jaws.
Bad show.
I give the Schmengis credit because they were always trying to modernize. They weren't content just to play Doo Doo Lichmere and Hanson.
Oh, they were just crooks. They really were.
They were trying to, like, you know, do Michael Jackson stuff on the accordion.
They ripped off Michael Jackson, yeah.
Let me ask you, Yash, do the Schmengis have groupies?
Oh, we've got groupies and, you know, Lutonian groupies. And believe me, you don't want to know them. Too many cabbage rolls on those girls.
it was necessary when the Schmengis finally called it quits. Just as the band had made their final statement in the last waltz, it was necessary for the two of you
to say goodbye, to retire in the way accustomed befitting us and our fans.
The last polka.
The last polka. But who's to say it's the last one, you know, if the money were right, say, you know. a comeback could be in order.
Kind of a documentary-style flick with people yes. pontificating on the sociological significance yes. of the Schmengis.
I love the barbecue we had in the backyard that kept getting bigger and bigger. You know, as it kept getting back to the raging fire. These guys were terrible. They're such a... What do they do? Something like 200 albums in a year. They were cranking them out one a week.
They have to be productive.
They were cranking them out.
How about when Joe Flaherty would play Sammy Maudlin? The reason I bring this up is that tomorrow night, we're not approaching a quarter century like Carson, but tomorrow night is our first anniversary special.
Yes, and happy first, by the way.
Thank you. And that brings to mind one of the great Sammy Maudlin moments. Here's Flaherty, and you're his Ed McMahon-style sidekick, William B.
Bad shit.
And you know the bit I'm thinking about.
He made me do that too, you know? He made me do that character. That's how that character came. Just do that cheap laugh you do. What? Just do that laugh and we'll go. William B. Williams. I said, I don't look like William B. Williams, who was the radio announcer.
Yeah.
I said, I don't look like him. We're just using his name. It's a funny name. And he said, just do that laugh. And from that point on, you know, that's all I. Because I always hated doing that character. I just had to sit there. All these guys were getting all the laughs. I was,
good, Sam, good.
And everybody would turn on me, you know? Shut up, William B.
Yes, okay. All right, Bobby.
The high point, or maybe the low point, came when, in a striking parallel to the Ed Ames tomahawk yes. incident.
Oh, God, that was funny. With a rock.
Can you recreate it?
Throwing a rock. Gene played the Ed Ames character in it, and he came out in a full warrior's outfit, feathers, and he was going to throw a rock and knock an apple off my head or something. And William B. had a very young, high voice, too, William B. had, remember? All right, Sammy, I'm ready for it. And he missed. And he hit exactly where Ed Ames hit on the Johnny Carson show, only with a rock.
And how did William B.'s laugh sound after that?
Sammy, that's not funny. Quit laughing, Sam. I'm in pain here. Sammy, they were laughing their butts off. Oh, God.
We'll be back.
Oh, that was funny.
Uncle Buck, out just this week.
Yeah.
Typical John Hughes movie in that virtually every adult is totally unsympathetic.
Yes, I know.
Except
for me, I hope, in this one.
Kindly old Uncle Buck.
Yes. What a wonderful character. It was fun to do. John really has a knack with those scripts, and he's got a knack for the dialogue, you know, of what's going on today. It's interesting, because the whole picture, for me, always, you know, was really just communication and who's listening and who's not to each other.
What's your favorite bit of business that Uncle Buck winds up doing? And for those who haven't seen it yet, Uncle Buck is a kind-hearted, bumbling, ne'er-do-well guy mm-hmm. who is pressed into service to watch his nieces and nephews while the parents go off on an emergency.
Well, but I couldn't have done that. I was trying to figure out what I was going to say. Geez, there were so many in there that would... The scene with the teacher was fun to do, with the melanoma,
yeah.
the laundry scene.
Before we run, let's talk about Radio Canada.
Okay.
So you get to do a lot of stuff, you know, pretty much at your own whim.
Yeah, that's as close creatively the freedom we have that I've had in a long time. And I paid for it myself. That's what we split
syndicated
with
radio,
radio
show.
Yeah, and we're in about 325 markets called Radio Candy. I don't know, with a K. All right, we went clever there. Sorry, Bob. Joe Flaherty's in it, Dave Thomas, Valerie Bromfield, Ira Miller, Royce Applegate, Who am I leaving out? Mike Short is working on it. Jimmy Doohan, who is Scotty in Star Trek, is our engineer on the show. The only place we haven't sold it is New York.
Really?
Yes, for some reason the stations here didn't want it. I don't know. It was real silly.
One bit couldn't you did it. Was Rocky V, which turned out to have nothing to do with Sly Stallone.
Right. It was actually, we had June Foray on, who was the Rocky of Rocky and Bullwinkle.
Uh-huh.
It was Rocky V, Rocky versus Bullwinkle.
Open now all around the country, and I assume in John Candy's native Canada, right?
We certainly hope so.
It is Uncle Buck. You get a chance, go and see it. And if you get a chance, be with us again tomorrow night. It's our first anniversary special. That's right, folks. Believe it or not, we've been here for a year, and we take over the Friday night video slot tomorrow after Letterman for a 90-minute look back at some of the highlights of our first year on the air. Thanks, John.
Thank you very much,
okay.
Bob. Happy anniversary.
Thanks, and we'll see you later.
Stay up later tonight for a great show with Andrea Martin and Bob Costas.
I just can't think of a thing.
Thanks for staying up later. We're spending this portion of the evening, I guess it's past evening time, what do we call this now? We call this late night, I guess, with a maniac.
Mm-mm.
They call people from Maine maniacs?
Mm. Gee, that's a hard one to live up to. Yeah. From Maine, right, maniacs.
Andrea Martin, ladies and gentlemen. What do they actually call people from Maine? What's the, like?
I think actually it is maniac.
Get out of here.
I swear to God, Bob, I'm not going to kid you in the first few minutes of the show. We got to establish a trust thing.
We do.
I swear.
If a rapport develops, good things will flow from it, I think.
Well, and hopefully another half hour. So yeah. It's all working.
She's
out.
Already bucking for a second show here.
Please.
Are people from New England?
That and an agent. What?
Are people from New England naturally funny? Because I guess the stereotype would be of sort of terse, taciturn people.
Gee, what is a stereotype of New England? I think of the Kennedy family or something when I think of New England. I don't think of Armenians. Does that group come to mind?
Generally not.
So, let's see, an Armenian in Portland. There's actually a community of Armenian people, not as big as Fresno. I think of tennis, I think of hair bands, and I think of Vassar when I think of New England.
And when I look at you.
You don't see any of those.
No, I think of Edith Prickly.
You do? Well, she.
Edith Prickly, the station manager at SCTV, a woman with a magnificent wardrobe.
Yeah, you know, as I was walking in here today, thinking I look really kind of feminine, attractive, the fellow at the door said, "Where are your pointy glasses?" I said, "I'm trying to change my persona." "Don't do it," he said. So I walked upstairs in the elevator. Is that what you think of, Edith Prickly?
Well, one of the things I think of. If Edith Prickly were running NBC,
yeah.
What would be the first move she'd make?
Make one entrance. Isn't it hard to get into this place?
Yeah, it really is. You got to run a gauntlet of security.
You do, don't you? Really, I would just, yeah.
You would
no revolving doors.
You would think something worth
one
protecting.
One thing you push through, that's it.
That's it.
You know what I mean? Easy to get your luggage through, wardrobe, come upstairs, call it a day. Yeah, that's what I'd do.
And would Edith then, you know, kind of clear Bob Costas out of here and get Libby Wolfson into the chair?
No, she wouldn't. She likes men. Edith?
Edith loves men. But Libby Wolfson, you know, would be the SCTV talk show host.
I love the way you're leading me into this.
I'm trying
to set you.
You're doing nothing here. Look, you don't understand. This is a nice rocking chair thing I got here.
Yes.
I throw a softball over the plate, you knock it over the fence, pretty soon a half hour is over with.
This is it.
You go out the door, I pick up the check, and then I go do a ball game on the weekends. Now, if you mess this thing up and make me work, I'm going to get very, very testy.
So let me get it. You say a character's name, and I'm supposed to break into it. Give it to me again.
Well, if you just want to do it that way.
Yeah, we're supposed to pretend. All right. Libby Wolfson.
Libby Wolfson.
Did you like Libby Wolfson?
Libby Wolfson.
Are so beautiful. To me. Can't you see? You are so beautiful. What is the, is there a smell here? Or is it, Bob, did, something? Well, you're supposed to come back with an answer. What is this, a monologue?
It's not me. It's not me.
What the hell? You might as well leave and I'll just go talk to the camera.
I'm sorry. I'm Libby's guest now.
Bob Costas, how are you?
fine. It's a pleasure. It's a great pleasure.
Is it, Bob?
It is. I'm a little nervous.
Don't be nervous.
I've seen you so
often.
I'm
going to lead you through it.
You are?
Are you married?
I am married.
In therapy?
I wasn't married in therapy, no.
No.
I was married in a church.
Oh, and he's a comedian. Isn't it something? Bob, what do you do exactly?
I've been trying to figure that out, but thus far it's worked.
Yeah. I think we make a good combo.
I sit here.
Mm-hmm.
I chat.
Mm-hmm.
A half hour goes by.
Very good.
Everybody's happy.
But enough about you.
Thank you.
You know, talk shows. They come, they go. But somebody who's staying here, who's come a long way to be here, is Mr. Bob Costas. He's my guest today, and after we come back from a station break, we'll talk to him. Are we off? Could I have the floss now? Because a piece of meat is stuck in my tooth, Bob. All during the talk, the fat part of the meat stuck in there.
Well, that white part.
It was very hard to talk to you. Mm-hmm.
Now, you asked me if I was in therapy.
Mm.
Dr. Cheryl Kinsey, if I needed that kind of therapy,
yeah.
wouldn't she be the one to call apart or tear apart?
Dr. Cheryl Kinsey is a sex therapist, you know.
Yes.
Do you need that kind of help, Bob?
For the purposes of this bit, yes, I do.
Oh, it's not a bit. It's my career. You know, Bob, how many times have you asked yourself, where do the women go when I need them?
Constantly.
Mm-hmm. Perhaps you should examine yourself and see if
right
everything's
here?
There.
Right here, right now.
It's late night.
It's very late night.
Yeah.
Where do the characters come from? Are they all your own invention, or do you take other people's suggestions?
People's ideas sometimes, too. I don't know. I go to malls sometimes and look at people. Sometimes just a quirky thing that somebody does, like in a subway or something, makes me sort of fantasize about what they're like. And just from that one characteristic, I get something. Under the pressure of the moment, you know, when I was doing improvisation with Second City, that's how Edith Prickly started. We were backstage and there were costumes there. In fact, that Edith Prickly jacket and hat was a outfit that Catherine O'Hara's mother had, and Catherine brought it to the theater. And we were doing a scene about parents and teachers, and I was playing a parent of a juvenile delinquent boy, Sebastian Prickly. And I was backstage, put the outfit on, came through the door. Catherine said, "And you must be Mrs. Prickly." I said, "That's right, dear Edith Prickly. Prickly's a name, parenting's a game." And that's how the character started. It was really under pressure to think of sort of a woman that wouldn't have a child that was too much in control,
mm-hmm.
you know? But now I don't really have that kind of opportunity to create things like that within that sort of generic form. Now I have to sort of sit and write them and think about...
Can you look at yourself in the mirror all of a sudden one day in a moment of inspiration and say, I can see, with just a little alteration somewhere in there, I see Indira Gandhi.
Thank you very much. It's very good to be here. After what I've been through, it's very good to be anywhere. Stand back, Rahul Pundi, because you're going to get what you're going to get in me, just a little touch of Stakwa Lati. No.
Indira as Evita.
That's right. That was Indira as Evita. Right.
Mm-hmm. But seriously, because you're so malleable in that way. I mean, you can become all of these different people, mm-hmm. not just as, you know, in appearance. You can eventually come out the chute looking quite a bit like these people you're portraying.
Yeah. I don't know if it's that when I look at myself, because I don't really think I do look like different people when I do things, to tell you the truth. I think that maybe what you're identifying with is something, some grain of truth, something funny within that character that I can bring to it. I think I'm very limited by my looks, actually. I think I have very strong looks, and you know, for a long time I wanted to play Ingrid Bergman on the show, and I swear, you know, I did do her, but who are we kidding? You know, I looked more like Mother Teresa when I did it. So that doesn't stop me, to tell you the truth. You know, if I think something's funny, then I'll go for it, even though I might not look like the person.
But you got to have friends. The feelings are so strong. Here is where I'll stay.
How much of what we saw as the classic SCTV bits through the years, with all the variety of performers, how much of that was spontaneous, where it would be, all right, we have the structure of the character, we know what the character does, we know what the background is, the audience is familiar with it, and then basically we'll just wing it?
Oh, not very much, not on the television show, in the theater, yeah. Occasionally, you know, Joe Flaherty, who played Caballero, would improvise, because it would just be one little set, and we had to fill time so the camera would roll, and he was very comfortable with the camera. I did that quite a bit with Edith Prickly, but no, I'd say generally they were very written. You know, we change lines together on camera, but it's pretty hard with cameras to be changing things constantly, especially with the schedule we had, which was 17 hours a day, 6 days a week, so we had to be pretty, a little bit organized, you know, as much as we could within a sort of disarray of improvisation, but yeah, it was much more organized.
What was this contribution of yours to that Letterman Film Festival a couple of years ago? I remember Diane Sawyer had a piece, and I guess several people got a shot at it.
Bette Midler did. Michael J. Fox did, Michael Keaton did, and Catherine O'Hara and I did a piece on PMS.
Always a laugh-filled topic.
Well, you know, we tried to think of a subject for weeks, and we couldn't agree on anything. And Catherine actually, one day, it was like we had 2 days left to think of an idea, and she was like this, oh, God, I don't know. I just can't think of a thing. I have never suffered from PMS, didn't even know about it. And out of her pain came this 7-minute film on PMS. And actually, the process of writing it was the most fun. She actually wrote it because she understood it. And all I could do was say, really? That happens? Wow, that must really hurt. That was my contribution. Then we shot the film. And people have responded to that. I don't think women could talk about PMS and laugh about it until they saw this film, you know? And I've had calls from doctors, nurses, teachers doing seminars on PMS, and then it became a real issue and subject. Now there are pills out for it, and it, I don't know, sort of an innovative kind of a thing. Yeah, and I loved the film, and it was funny, too.
It was definitely uncharted comedic territory.
Boy, was it ever, sure. Yeah.
Nothing hackneyed about jokes on that subject.
Nope. Pretty original. That's right.
Are your parents still living?
Uh-huh.
Do they get what you do? Apart from being happy that you're successful and they can see you on TV and people know who you are, do they get it? Do their friends get it?
No. I don't think they do. They're really supportive. They want to get it. You know, they really want to understand. I think it's hard for a father to see his little girl in leopard skin and glasses and not being really feminine, you know? Your father wants a daughter to grow up with crinoline skirts and be real proper and sweet and a lady and be a housewife and bring up children, and that's not what they got.
But I could just see somebody's, you know, Uncle Bert and Aunt Gertrude saying, yeah, I know it's supposed to be funny, but why don't you tell jokes?
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Tell me a joke.
Right, I think my parents and my family really like it when I do things that are mainstream. When I did when I was on the Carlson show, I think that to them was really making it. And
they think the Letterman show is like a cable show, right?
They don't see. Yeah, that's right. Letterman is like SCTV. You know, it's. I guess some people like it, but who would they be? Late night bums or something would be up that late. You know, I don't think they even know you exist. You know, they're going to turn the TV off after Letterman. We know that. But this night, they'll be watching it.
On the Showtime special, Together Again, the premise was that you'd had a nervous breakdown. Mm-hmm. And that allowed you to go off in different directions, welcome people back, some of them real, some of them fictitious.
Right. I guess I exaggerated my own life, you know, trying to put all the elements together, being a mom, having kids, a marriage, and the career, and my parents supporting me, and all that, you know, all things that were kind of close to me, but I needed to exaggerate it. To tell you the truth, we shot the show in not a particularly exaggerated way, so she wasn't really having a nervous breakdown. She was calling her friends, Andrea Martin, calling her friends back to celebrate the new her, you know. But I saw the show, and I thought, Jesus, this is boring. What am I going to do? So we reshot the scenes on stage to make her really exaggerated, to have had a nervous breakdown.
My favorite part of the whole thing was when you ripped Paul Simon off and brought in these bogus guys from South Africa, a la Graceland.
Yeah, gee, I like that too. That was, that made me laugh. The Robert and Butu singers, right? Now, you see, again, now, did you think I was making fun of the singers? Did you think I was making fun of singers who take themselves very seriously?
The latter, and then also making fun of somebody like the exaggerated Andrea Martin, whom you were portraying, would be so pretentious as to think that, like, she could give herself some artistic credentials by knowing somebody for 2 weeks and bringing them on stage.
Oh, how nice that you listened to those lyrics. That's really great. I love that. I love that piece. And I love you, Bob.
Thank you. I'm deeply moved.
I don't think you understand how much I love you for saying that.
Well,
I'm desperate, really,
for any kind
of attention.
We have time for an explanation, Andrea.
that was a funny piece, yeah. I went back to Africa, there to find my roots. Do you know the lyrics?
No, I figured you would. You'd be in a better position than I.
Went back there to find my roots. Thank God you edit this, because wouldn't this be a moment, you know?
Your movie Worth Winning opens around the country in late October.
Mm-hmm.
Mark Harmon's in it.
Mark Blum, Leslie Ann Warren, Madeline Stowe.
And what's it about?
It's about a man who makes a bet with his friend that he can propose to three different women and they will all accept. And it might sound male chauvinistic, but in the end, the women all get even, and I am one of the women that helped get the women who he's proposed to even back to him.
You're looking to foil Mark Harmon's narcissistic plan.
There you go. That's it. Right. Absolutely. So instead of playing the best friend, I am the wife of the best friend. It's a new thing. Stretch for me.
It's time to leave. Would you just say see you later and we'll get out of here before we embarrass ourselves any further?
Oh, I'm on a roll. It's time to leave. And just to play it safe, I'm going to be relating to every camera. Good night. See you later. Thanks so much for watching. This is Bob Costas and Andrea Martin saying good night.
Good night. We've enjoyed it tremendously.
Where are you going, Bob?
I'm
Bob,
the
honey.
Show's over.
I'm here with the crew.
Over.
What will
Goodbye.
I do?
Bye. See ya.
Oh, this has been fun.
So long. Bye-bye. Oh, jeez.
Stay up later tonight, because Bob Costas is making music history with Eugene Levy.
If this is a television first, it has to be the smallest television first, I think.
Thanks for staying up later. Eugene Levy is here from SCTV fame. Now, suppose the tables were turned, and this were the Sammy Maudlin show.
Uh-huh.
And you were Bobby Bittman.
Let's say.
Let's just say. This is a wild premise that just came to me at this moment.
Uh-huh.
How would Bobby converse in this situation?
Well, it wouldn't be a quiet opening. Okay. How are you?
How are you?
You know, Bob, it's such a fantastic feeling being back in New York City because, as you know, my roots are here, and every time I come back, I get a kick out of it. And but as a comic, in all seriousness, I think the town has changed for the good, and I'm glad to be here to be a part of that and see it, and to be on your show.
The Sammy Maudlin show, right, was modeled after, or at least the inspiration came from Sammy and Company.
Yes.
The old Sammy Davis thing. Now, yeah. I vaguely recall the show, but I don't recall who Sammy used to have on. Was there somebody who corresponded to Bobby Bittman, somebody who corresponded to Johnny LaRue?
No, I don't think any of the characters are related to specific guests that were on, but when we were doing the Second City stage show in Pasadena in 1975, it was the first time we caught Sammy and Company because we never got the show. The show was never broadcast in Canada, so never seen it. And we saw Sammy and Company. And the thing about the Sammy Davis show was that he would always be patting somebody on the back, no matter who was sitting on the stool beside him. You know, it was just, you know, well, let me tell you something about this man here, because, you know, nobody really knows
the amount of charity work, you know, that this man really does. He has done, he goes off and lists 10 things, and then the guest would come back and top him. He'd say, well, Sammy, you know, it's very nice of you to say that, but, you know, you are a workhorse. And, oh, please, please, please. No. I think the audience should know this. And that was the whole show.
Jerry Lewis.
Yeah.
Another guy who played right into your hands with the solid gold telethon.
Well, we had some fun. Jerry Lewis, incidentally, was, you know, when I was a kid, that was the, you know, one of the biggest things in the world was waiting for the next Lewis film to come out. I think I was watching the Colgate Comedy Hour on Sunday nights when most of the world was, you know, watching the Ed Sullivan Show, because Martin and Lewis mm-hmm. would frequent that show a lot, you know. And and then when Jerry Lewis went on his own with Delicate Delinquent in 1957, that was, I think, the funniest film I'd ever seen in my life, you know. And it was, I mean, I was a Jerry Lewis fanatic, you know. Couldn't wait for the next Lewis film. I used part of Jerry Lewis as a model for my Bittman character, not so much as an impersonation, but just, what was the question?
Well, the show was going to go off the air. Remember, the show was going to go off the air, and you staged a telethon.
The solid gold telethon. Yeah.
You staged a telethon, and everybody came out.
Yeah.
And they shamelessly pleaded for money.
We're trying to keep our station on the air, you know? So our thing was send in anything that's gold. Solid gold telethon, and, you know, we had our own, you know, poster child, and, you know, kind of a gold bullion cube.
A little kid in a gold bullion's head sticking out of this gold block.
I know. Shameless.
What do you think Earl Cannon Bear's view of the general decline of journalistic standards in television would be?
Well, I don't think he's thought much about it. He's probably just preparing the copy for his next news broadcast. See, that's the great thing about parody, though. Over the years, you come to realize that, you know, parody is just too easy. Putting a pinprick in things that people do, work that people actually have created and, you know, gotten, whether it's a film or TV or whatever, and then it's easy to kind of look at it and, you know, prick it with a little pin and just say, ah, you know, seeing little, it's easy, parody's easy.
And Splash, you're the guy sitting in the dentist chair and you wind up getting accidentally injected in the leg and then you're jellyfishing all over the room.
The only thing I recall about the scene was I'm not really noted as being a physical comedian. In fact, you know, over the next half hour, you know, this leg will stay where it is. You know, I don't move that much, and the having a leg collapse is tough to do, to actually get up, have one leg collapse, and then, you know, so it was done on the first take, and it seemed to work. If I'd had to do it again, I probably don't think I could have done it again or made it look as good. I mean, it was just something that happened, and it worked.
I read somewhere where you said to yourself, you're really not a comedian. Sketch player, character guy, but not a comedian in the classic way we'd understand that.
Well, this is true. I think the, well, not so much ironic, but one of the biggest enigmas about myself, I think, is that the only thing I've done since I started working in this business has been comedy. And I like it, and I think I'm good at it. But, you know, I'm not a funny person by nature. I think I'm...
Do you feel funnier when you can put on the artifice of a character as opposed to just sitting here?
I approach my work, even on SCTV, I mean, over and above writing this stuff, but as I guess an actor would approach his work, which is, you know, you try and pour yourself into a character, and then, you know, I mean, Bobby Bittman was always a kick to do because, you know, he's such a loud, obnoxious personality that it was fun to play somebody like that. Yeah. I mean, you know.
Were any of the SCTV guys stand-ups? Was Dave Thomas a stand-up guy? Was Moranis, John Candy,
no.
Short?
Actually, the first time, well, I've got a story about Marty, but I don't know whether He'd be that thrilled with it. I think the first time I met Rick Moranis, he was doing a stand-up act with a partner. They were called Cowan and Moranis. And this was some pilot done out in Newfoundland, I think, in 76, just before SCTV came on the air. And it was kind of funny. I didn't know who he was. Rick started in radio as a disc jockey, but went into kind of a stand-up thing with his partner, and the material was kind of funny, and thought he was kind of funny. Nobody else in the group got into stand-up. You know, stand-up is very, well, you got to be sick to be a stand-up comedian. I mean, you've got to get up there and just take so much rejection.
What happened with Martin Short? Come on,
well,
you can
Marty.
Tell us.
I think he tried once in his career. He tried stand-up comedy, and that was in Toronto. And it was a small club, and there was a band very quickly, because it's a lengthy story. So this leg's going to stay right where it is.
Keep an eye.
Because it's a comfy position right now. But there was a band called Rough Trade, which had a tune chosen for the movie Cruisin'. Kind of tells you know where their audience is. They were kind of an avant-garde, kind of a raunchy group, and they had a tough following. And the singer in the group asked Marty, and we knew her. She was a friend of our group, kind of, and asked Marty if he'd like to open for this gig at this little club. And he said, well, sure, because he was kind of thinking about stand-up comedy. Maybe I should try it. Maybe I shouldn't. So we said, okay. So the night of the show. The show went up an hour late, so everybody had an hour more to juice, and it was bad. It was a bad crowd. And then somebody came up to the mic and said, "Ladies and gentlemen, Marty Short," you know, and nobody knew there was a warm-up act. Nobody knew who he was. Nobody, whatever. And literally took 15 minutes before Marty could get a word out at the mic. I mean, the audience was that loud. There was a guy in the audience. There's a guy doing a sheep impersonation.
But a good sheep impersonation.
A great sheep impression, because he was breaking up the room. I mean, he had the crowd before Marty said good evening. You know? And then everybody else was, you know, get off the stage. Right. Get, who do you think? So he started going into his stuff, could not be heard. The audience was that loud. The sheep, you know, that guy was getting all the laughs. Couldn't hear Marty. He kept going on 15 minutes. I was there with my wife, and you know, she was like, you know, under the table, just clutching my knee, digging her nails in. It was that. I said, well, should we leave? Should we, you know, do you want to what? You know, I said, and I kept thinking, Marty, you know, just leave the stage. Just leave the stage. What, I mean, what are people going to do? They're going to applaud. You know, they want the band. Why are you doing this to yourself? Why? I mean, if I was in his shoes, they'd carry me out. And so he started into this, and then one guy walks down the entire room with a beer, and he throws the beer in Marty's face up on stage. And now I'm sitting there like, all right, you know, really, just leave. Just leave. Walk off. And Marty just stood there, let the beer drip, and then finished his joke, because he was right in the middle of a joke. Then he went on and gave the punchline, and then threw in a line about, you know, the size of, you know, the man's
whatever.
And that got a few chuckles, and then he kept going, and he started to win the audience over. And I'd say by the time he finished, he had won maybe 40% of the audience over, 40% in that crowd, and that was pretty good. And then after the show, I mean, women were crying. His friends, like, you know, were just, like, sobbing. I mean, it was that bad. And I said, Marty, why didn't you just leave the stage? Why did you put yourself through that? And, you know, Marty's approach was kind of analytical. He said, well, and he was kind of, that's kind of the way. Well, I thought there's got to be a way of winning them over. There's got to be a way of winning them over. And I said, well, you were born to do what it is you're doing. I mean, you're a born performer. That's the difference between you and me. Because I would have got the first bus, you know, out of town. I would have said, well, who needs it?
Or maybe he should have been like Sandler and Young. Guys oblivious, at least in the SCTV universe, to how bad they are. So when they come on the show, they can get no laughs, absolutely take a nosedive off the high board, and they don't understand that everyone thinks they stink.
Mm. So we had a lot of fun playing those two, me and Marty. We had, you know, that was good. Because they came, you know, they came on, they did their thing, they were all smiles, all showbiz.
Do you think that Lutonia is a freer nation now, in light of these developments in Eastern Europe, you know, all these communist dictatorships falling in a domino effect?
Well, you know, Bob.
Thank you, Stan.
There are people in Lutonia now that are flipping cabbage rolls high into the air because the wall came tumbling down, you know, and it's about time. Now, a country known mostly for having no trees now has something else to celebrate. Freedom.
You think now that the walls are down, both literally and figuratively, that sales of the Schmengi Brothers records might surge in Lutonia?
Well, we're hoping. Not that we didn't make a few back then. We recorded one album a month in our heyday. But then a few albums there, the government thought maybe perhaps we're making a statement contrary to the beliefs of the government at that time. So some of them were taken off the shelves and never got a chance to be heard by the public. So I'm hoping now that the albums will be back on the shelves for all the Lutonians to hear.
Well, my friends, this is truly a proud and happy moment.
If this is a television first, it has to be the smallest television first, I think.
I've been inspired by the Schmengi Brothers. Well, can I be an honorary, if not brother, perhaps a distant cousin?
Cousin Milt.
Cousin Milt.
Yes.
The truth is that I took accordion lessons. When I was 7 and 8 years old, my grandparents prevailed upon my parents, mm-hmm. convinced them that every well-rounded young man plays a musical instrument. And they selected the accordion. I had a Myron Florin songbook from the Lawrence Welk Show, and I remember my grandmother repeatedly assuring me, you'll be very popular at parties. Mm-hmm. The girls love a guy who plays a musical instrument.
You aimed so high back then,
didn't
you?
This is the one. This is the one that
okay, so is this the...
Well, there's only one song I remember.
Well, it's got to be. It has to be.
I can barely play that.
A one.
Oh, I'm ahead of you.
A two. A one, two, three.
I told you I haven't played it since 1959.
Oh, there's no coordination. There's no coordination. Let's hear it.
Paul, why, the later musical director, Paul Shaffer.
Come on, lady, let me hear it.
Yeah.
You got to go slower. You got to go faster.
All right. No, okay?
You go slower.
No. I insist.
No.
Let me just sit back and watch.
No,
you're a
talented
man.
Here, take mine too.
What, yours? All right, here we go. Hit it.
Tonight on Later, Canadian talk show techniques from comedian Dave Thomas.
Beat the hell out of each other for three rounds, and then the last guy left standing at the end of the evening is the winner.
Thanks for staying up later. Dave Thomas is with us now, and I guess you got a problem. In fact, you've even alluded to it in your act. Dave Thomas, which is not the most distinctive name in the world, is probably 100 Dave Thomases, if not more, in the average big city phone book. But now you got serious TV competition with this Wendy's guy.
I know. It's sad, really. I mean, I called them up and I said, you know, for a little more money, you could have the real Dave Thomas, do your commercial for you. That was my joke, but I don't think they thought that was too funny. I said, how about getting a young guy instead of that old, fat, bald guy that's doing your spots, you know? But it is a common name, and even when I live in Los Angeles now, but I came in through Toronto. I was up there doing something, and I came in through U.S. Customs and Immigration. They said, Dave Thomas, yeah. You ever worked for General Motors, Mr. Thomas? I said, no, I haven't. Okay, go on through. So they're looking for a Dave Thomas that worked for General Motors. So if you're out there, Dave, if you're waiting for your profile on America's Most Wanted, get hit, duck for cover.
You know, last October, the customs officials in Toronto, not all of them and not in every case, mm-hmm. but if you went through there and said you worked for NBC and you were covering the baseball playoffs,
yeah,
they tended to give you a little bit harder time.
Really,
yeah, because they were all mad at me.
Is that right?
Because they were convinced that I was rooting against the Blue Jays. Against the Blue Jays and for the Oakland A's in the playoffs.
Yeah.
And all I was doing was telling the world that the A's were
beating the Blue Jays' brains in, which is what they were doing. And Canadians can get a little bit sensitive.
Oh, yeah. It's strange, too, because, you know, then you do something like the McKenzie brothers where you sort of disgrace them internationally, and they were complimented by it. So, I mean, you figure it out. I sure couldn't.
Most Canadians were happy with that?
Yeah, they thought it was great. You put us on the map, eh? Good going, eh? And, yeah, well, my pleasure. But, you know, we never meant it as, you know, really as a national parody. We just did it as a cheap little sketch, But then when we saw the way it was getting, you know, received in the States, we thought, oh, that's a pretty crappy image for Canada,
But when you come to think of it, right, what you and Moranis did with the McKenzie brothers shouldn't suggest to anybody that that's all Canadians. It's just a couple of guys, than Gomer Pyle is all Americans or all people who live in the South.
That's true, though. But, you know, writers will just sort of like, they got to fill ink and pages and, you know, so they'll just make stuff up. And then the people will read it and go, why, yes, this is true. And then the next thing you know, you're responding to something that some writer just made up. So, you know, we became sort of like, you know, identity and figures of Canadian identity and kind of cultural. We're in sociology books, the two McKenzie brothers. I mean, you know.
They nominated you for the Royal Order of Canada for the McKenzie brothers, right?
It was sort of silly. We got notification that we were being considered for the Order of Canada. And for those of you people who don't know, that's sort of a thing reserved for, you know, someone who invents a vaccination or does something serious, a major contribution, you know, and not like a sketch on television. And I don't know. It was silly. It was definitely blown out of proportion. But it was fun while we did it. It was a great ride for a few weeks. It became sort of a pain in the butt after a while, and we stopped. So it was good to dump it and get out of it and move on, you know?
My personal favorite of all the things that you've done was your Bob Hope. And you think about Bob Hope, a guy who's been a fixture for decades and decades. Nobody, at least to my knowledge, ever nailed him, ever got him exactly right until you did. Mm-hmm. Why was he so hard to do, at least for everybody else?
Gee, I don't know. I think he's, because he's kind of in the middle there, you know, he doesn't really have a distinguishable voice that, you know. But I'll tell you how I got to him. Brian Doyle and Murray, Bill's brothers, saw me just clowning around. And my early impersonations of Bob Hope were just a high, whiny voice of Bob Hope up here. Hi, ladies and gentlemen. It was more like that, you know.
Yeah.
And I hadn't really refined it. And Brian said, that's funny, you know, you ought to do something with that. And Brian's kind of got a gravelly voice. And he said, so we started kicking around ideas, and we came up with the Bob Hope Desert Classic. And it was like combining golf and war, the two things that are really kind of big in Bob's life, or were at that time. And so we wrote this piece, and then I was sitting in makeup, and I was getting real scared she was putting a false nose on, because I thought, now I'm going to commit to doing this in front of the camera, and I don't really know how to do it. And Bev Sheckman was doing the makeup, and I said, well, Bev, I said, he's got a bigger jaw than me. We were looking at a photo of him. And she says, yeah, honey, but I don't think I can put a jaw on because, you know, you start moving it and it'll fall off. And I said, oh, yeah, yeah, because we were using putty. We didn't have foam prosthetics at that time. So I said, all right. I said, why don't I just stick my jaw out? And as soon as I stuck my jaw out like that, it was like, oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, and then I found a little spot where I could cup. And then all of a sudden it was like, oh, I get it. Yeah, yeah. And then the eyes and the thing, yeah, yeah, Bob Hope. I'll tell you, the piece he loved the most was the writers in China, you know, trying to come up with jokes, Chinese jokes, topical Chinese jokes. He laughed his head off in that. And the other stuff that was conceptual, because it isn't his kind of comedy. He just kind of, yeah, yeah, no, that's good, that's great. Yeah, how much it cost you to do that? And he started pumping me about the business of the show, you know. What's your budget? Yeah, yeah. Don't you get deals up in Canada there, don't you? Yeah, that's, yeah, I don't get those deals down here, you know, with Bob Hope Enterprises, you know. So he was the president of Bob Hope Enterprises when he was, you know, slipping into that stuff too, you know.
Who did you really hurt, at least according to their account? Did anyone ever call you and say, you cut me to the quick. Please don't do it anymore.
No. Well, if they did, they never called me and told me. I'm sure there were people who felt that way, but I never heard from them.
Who'd you take some wicked pleasure in
nailing?
Well,
I took some shots at Richard Harris. When he sang MacArthur Park,
yeah.
I thought, a non-singer singing the longest, most potent, you know, pompous song in the world. And then, so I did him as sort of the guest on American Bandstand on
lip-syncing it?
Yeah, lip-syncing it. I mean, that was sort of, I think, the hardest edge I ever took at anybody.
Martin Short was here about a year ago, and I asked him the same question. I'll give you a crack at it. So many of the major comedy stars of the last decade or so
especially for the younger generation, came out of Canada. Mm-hmm. Yourself, Rick Moranis, and Martin Short, and John Candy, and Andrea Martin. There are others.
Dan Aykroyd.
Mm-hmm. Is there some particular advantage to viewing American culture from a distance, but not that great a distance? Is that the edge that a Canadian funny man has?
Well, I don't know. I'll tell you one advantage I had, well, that other Canadians had as well, is that you get all the American TV and British TV and then some original Canadian programming. And consequently, you're able to see kind of a multicultural view, if you can call two countries multicultural. But anyway, you get to see more than one view of things, and maybe that helped. I really think it's like one of those things, though, where, you know, at one point there'll be five actors who've done well that come from Utah, and it's just one of those statistical odd things that happens, you know, because, I don't have a good answer. Did they do well with their answers? I did very badly.
Smiling faces sometimes, they don't tell the truth. Smiling faces tell lies, and I got proof. Oh, Lord, yeah. Let me tell you, the truth is in the
Back now with Dave Thomas. Tell me about the riot that broke out in Cleveland.
Oh, geez. Well, this was a while ago, but we did a show also for CBS, and a producer named Rocco or BC talked us into going to Cleveland to do the show, and we all wondered why the whole time we were doing it. And I ended up at this place. We did numerous pieces throughout the show. We were in the flats for one show and in Shaker Heights for another piece in the show, and then we were in a place called the Coliseum, which is outside of Cleveland. And Rocco's idea was that we're going to do this piece at the annual Tough Man Fight, which is where they get kind of like, not professional fighters, but just guys to go in there and just...
Bar brawlers.
Yeah, beat the hell out of each other for three rounds. And then the last guy left standing at the end of the evening is the winner. And so his deal was, Dave, you go out and do your Bob Hope just before the decision fight. And so I went out there and to do Bob Hope. And... in a ring, in boxing ring, in front of 15,000 people, and I got a couple of jokes off, and then I sort of felt this side of the house pulling a bit, and by that I mean, if you've never been in front of that many people, it's just a weird feeling, and I've never played that many big rooms either, and so I just thought, something's going on over here, and then I noticed they were moving, and then I saw the camera go over, and the cue cards go over on this side, and I thought, oh boy, they really are moving. But I was still trying to keep the jokes going, you know. Maybe I can laugh them out of this. But what had happened, I heard later, was that some guy had thrown a beer bottle and hit a white guy had thrown a beer bottle and hit a black guy's kid in the head or something. And it was like, it was a race smash right there like that. And there were cops coming. I saw the cops coming. And then this fight promoter is screaming at me, get out of the ring, get out of the ring, you're causing a riot. And I'm like, I walk over to him as Bob Hope holding this mic. And I said, well, and I'm still in character. And I go, well, that wasn't the idea of this. We're supposed to get laughs. And I saw the tape later, you know, and I'm talking to this guy. Then a cop picks me up, and the mic cord, boom, goes out of my hand, and he lifts me over the ropes and hands me to another cop, and I'm being passed from cop to cop, and it's just mayhem in there. And I see Catherine O'Hara crying as I'm being passed from cop to cop, and I thought, what the hell happened? Did I get shot? And later on, I saw this tape of this thing. And they were, first they started throwing paper cups, and I was, became the lightning rod of their wrath, you know?
Yeah.
Of their wrath. And, or wrath.
Or of their wrath.
Worse than wrath.
That's right.
And And they started throwing cups, then beer bottles, then chairs. Folding chairs were coming into the room.
Yeah, and that is an appropriate order of progression, because paper cups, no matter how angrily they're thrown, they won't hurt you.
I know.
But you move up to a bottle, you're in some danger. And then when chairs get thrown in, all hell's broken loose.
I didn't get hit by anything. It was like I was in that Maxwell Smart's cone of silence, you know. And I was completely protected.
Now, I'll tell you, ladies and gentlemen, next to wars, I love doing gigs like this the most. Just one thing before I go. Cleveland, you are tough. So that's it, ladies and gentlemen, the end of the first annual Bob Hope Tough Man Classic. And remember, America, heart disease is still the number one killer, but don't neglect your glands. Good night.
Paul Schrader was there that evening, and he was doing some research for some street theater thing, you know, like the films he does. And he came back to the hotel. He said, I just wanted to meet you. He said, I never saw anything like that in my life. He said, that was the most bizarre thing. Because there was a riot there, and there were police with clubs and
it actually sounds like an Andy Kaufman bit. Yeah. That would have been Andy Kaufman's fondest dream, to have that thing happen around his act.
Well, if you knew what was going on, but, you know, I was genuinely stunned, you know. That was, like, in 1980, and I was really just sort of starting out, and I'd never been in front of that many people before, and I was scared out of my mind. And when those people laugh, it vibrates your whole body. But when they start booing you, it's sort of like all your cells, which are, like, mostly fluid, are assaulted with this noise, and it, like, scares the hell out of you. It's like 15,000 people booing me, I'm going to die, you know?
Difficult to rationalize that they're all mistaken.
Yeah, I know,
you know? All 15,000 booing you.
And, you know, I was actually thinking that at the time. I was thinking, gee, these people don't like Bob Hope that much. That's not very nice. He's from here. And then I went, wait a minute, Hope's in Toluca Lake. I'm here. This is me that's taking this, you know?
Was anybody seriously hurt?
No, I don't know. I mean, I think there were some heads batted around and some people arrested, but I didn't hear that anybody was killed or anything, you know. Someone was killed when we were doing the show on the roof of the hotel we were staying at. One night we heard pop, pop, pop. Sounded like firecrackers. And then the next day, man shot on top of Cleveland Hotel.
Was this during the same stay?
Yeah.
Where the riot broke out?
Yeah.
Kind of an eventful week.
It was an eventful week.
So what was the guy doing on the roof?
Well, I don't know. It's Cleveland. I mean, you know.
The Dave Thomas Show, it's on 10:30 on Monday nights on CBS.
That's right.
You got the big names on there with you.
Yeah,
Some of your old cohorts.
I got John Candy on the first show and Dan Aykroyd on the second show, and they're going to repeat the Chevy and Marty show, and Catherine O'Hara and John Rourke on the fourth show, and my old pal, country and western singer Johnny J. Folsom on the last show.
Johnny J. Folsom making a rare television
appearance? Making one of his rare television appearances out of a detox center. So, I mean, if you can get someone out of a detox center on your show, you want them, you know?
It goes without saying that all the people who worked on SCTV, some of whom slid over to other programs, are very talented. They each have their own areas where they shine. But you're especially fond of Dan Aykroyd and his ability, aren't you?
Well, I asked him to be on these specials that I'm doing right now, and I said, we've got some pieces that you could look at, Danny, that the writers and I have written. And he said, well, David, I'll tell you, what I'd like to do is a piece that I've always wanted to do, Beef Masters. I said, well, what's that? He said, you know, high-calorie cooking for those people that aren't afraid to pack on a few pounds and show it. And so we did, like, a high-calorie cooking show, and he brought out a 25-pound cake, which was burger meat covered with chocolate.
Did his performance in Driving Miss Daisy surprise you? Did you think that something like that was in his bag of tricks?
Oh, God, yeah. I mean, I know. There's so much more in his bag of tricks that I can't wait to see it, you know? I mean, it didn't surprise me at all that he'd be the first of any of the people from Saturday Night Live or Second City or National Lampoon or that sort of comedy group to get an Oscar nomination. It was just a question of, when are you going to do it, Danny? You know, but never surprised me, no.
Now, this is a role that anybody worth his salt really would have craved, and you've got it. You're Boris Badenoff.
Yeah.
In Boris and Natasha.
Yep. I had to dye my hair black and grow a mustache and dye that black. And keeping a mustache dyed black every day is really hard, you know?
Sally Kellerman is a lanky woman, but is the proportion the same as in the cartoon?
No.
Because Natasha really towers over Boris in the cartoon.
She had a terrible time in that show. She had to wear 5.5-inch spikes through the whole show and run in them, and they cut the heels off my shoes to get me down to the ground, you know? And so we tried with, like, you know, stacking ourselves on boxes and things like that to get the height closer to the cartoon. And Sally was much more diligent about it than me, you know? She will remember those things and push for them. She'll look at me in the shot and she'll go, no, no, no. Get down, crouch, get down lower, you know? So we tried to keep the proportion as close as we could to that, and it was mainly her shoes and my lack of them that did it, you know?
Do they have the whole collection of cartoon adversaries for them?
Bullwinkle and Rocky show up in the show.
But just briefly?
Yeah, just briefly, and as their sort of live-action counterparts would be. And so I don't want to blow it, but, you right. know, or tell you any more than that.
Dave Thomas Show is seen on CBS Monday nights at 10:30.
10:30.
And now it's 2 o'clock, at least in some portions of the country, which means it's time for you to go to bed, and we're gone. See you later.
Later with Bob Costas, Catherine O'Hara on the glamour of showbiz.
So I sort of left show business to start dating.
It's an either-or situation, huh?
Kind of is.
Thanks for staying up later. Catherine O'Hara of SCTV, recently a guest shot on SNL, and Home Alone 1 and 2 fame is with us. And Home Alone 2 opens around the country this coming Friday, mm-hmm. November the 20th. Mm-hmm. I saw a preview last week.
Did you?
And it pushes most of the same buttons. I mean, if you like the first one, you're going to be laughing at this one.
Oh, I think that's the idea. Give them more.
Not exactly... Not exactly trying to break any new ground. Just this, exactly the same relationship.
Oh,
let's
on.
Be
there
honest,
are
right?
New levels here. Like in the first movie, I played a woman who did this for the first time, and in the second movie, I'm doing it for the second time.
Oh, now I
There's
see.
There's a whole difference.
And
the burglars are getting it again from the same kid who got them before.
But in a different place.
Yeah. New stunts.
And in new and more inventive ways to inflict pain on
oh,
them.
Oh, definitely. Very good stunts.
Cartoon pain.
Yeah.
These guys bounce up pretty much like
oh, no
the Wile E. Coyote, no matter what happens to them.
I know. I think that's, I hope that's what's, what makes it okay for kids to see it and laugh at it, because they won't really, you know, then relate that to anything in their real lives. These are, they get all that frustration vented out on these two cartoon characters.
You look a little bit different sitting here than in the two films, but I would guess people still primarily recognize you from
yeah.
the Home Alone movies, and that's a little ironic because although you're funny, this isn't the typical Catherine O'Hara stuff. This is much straighter than the stuff that people know you for otherwise.
Well, I don't even play like a straight man. I play somebody with totally lacking a sense of humor. No sense of humor at all in this person. I finally realized that in the second movie. I knew I was fighting against something in the first movie, but I finally realized what it was. Every natural instinct.
So was it enjoyable then?
No. Yeah, it was fun. Yeah, it was. It was a challenge to... I mean, I like to think that I have a sense of humor, so it was a challenge to play somebody who didn't and, you know, and is sort of the thread of reality in this story, because so much of the other stuff with, you know, with Joe Pesci and Daniel Stern and Macaulay is all real funny and, you know, so I'm sort of the serious note.
I read somewhere, and maybe you said it or someone said it about you, when you were on SCTV and did a wide variety of characters, that you were a little bit like Dan Aykroyd on Saturday Night Live. Doing all these characters, and yet you didn't get that strong a sense of what his personality
right,
was. That he was completely absorbed in the character, and unlike, for example, Bill Murray, who could play characters,
right.
but you had a sense of who Bill was.
Right.
You feel that was true
of
you?
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Did you want it that way, or is just what who you are?
I think it's just, no, I didn't plan it, and I didn't even think about it being that way until later, you know, when they talk about TV cues and all that stuff when we had the shows on NBC and, you know, all that, whether people, you know, the recognition factor and all this. Then I did sort of think, why don't people know me? And so I came up with the excuse that, oh, I hide behind my characters or they may know my character. And I also didn't repeat my characters as often as some other people.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess, yeah, Andrea Martin was very good at always being Andrea in her characters. You know, always showing something. Marty Short does that. I think John Candy especially is, you know, very much John. Most of his characters were named John, the Johnny. I think it was just natural. I didn't plan it.
My favorite character was Joey Heatherton. I mean, not Joey.
Lola
Heatherton, the combination of Lola Falana and Joey Heatherton.
Well, I stole, from Lola Falana, I stole the quivering lip because I the night before I had to, we were going to write the Sammy Maudlin scene for an award show in Toronto. I didn't have a character for the Sammy Maudlin show, and I was trying to come up with one, and I was watching The Tonight Show, and Lola Falana was singing Sometimes When We Touch, and she was really working at the eyes, trying to work up some tears, and she had the lip going like that. I thought, ooh, that I'll use. And I'd always been, you know, fascinated with Joey Heatherton, just from the perfect, be a perfect sleeper, you know, those ads,
right.
Curtis. So I thought, hey, Joey, Lola, Heatherton. But otherwise, it wasn't, you know, based on either of them.
And the distinctive thing was, to punctuate everything, she threw her head back in that wild, manic laugh. Could you do that again, please? Sammy Maudlin was one of the most memorable bits that they did, and it captured,
yeah.
You know, not in a vicious way, but in a funny way, it captured the disdain that a lot of us felt for all those conventions of television and show business. But in a way, to do it right, you have to sort of like it.
Oh, yeah.
You have to sort of have ambivalent feelings about it.
Yeah.
Like, on the one hand, go, I don't ever want to be like this or have anyone think that I'm like this. On the other hand, gee, let's watch this,
yeah.
Right?
Oh, yeah, they were sort of endearing in their own twisted, sick way, I think, those characters. You had to feel for them, because, I don't know, it's just, you cannot fail if you play cocky, stupid character. And these people were so cocky and so somehow believed they had talent. And none of them really did. But they were just so aggressively non-talented. And they had such a support group going each other, you know? We are good. We are talented. It was just always so much fun to play those characters.
Generally, did you feel some, in the back of your mind, some misgiving about, I wonder if the object of this really is getting their feelings hurt? Like, I remember once I saw Gilda Radner say that she ran into Barbara Walters someplace.
Right.
And all of a sudden she was face to face with Baba Wawa. And apparently Barbara Walters tried to be gracious, but Gilda sensed, either really or she was projecting it, some kind of hurt in the thing, and she felt some reservation about it. Have you ever felt that way about anyone you portrayed?
Well, I think too that's because Gilda was so sweet and sensitive, and you know. But her take on everyone and on comedy was so light spirited. That, you know, she'd feel guilty about it, but I don't think she did anything mean-spirited. And actually, I emulated her. I understudied her and then took her place in Second City, so she was sort of my role model. And so I tried to do the same kind of thing, and once in a while, I probably, like I did Morgan Fairchild and something, and I hadn't really studied tapes of her, you know, I just sort of went in and did it with, yeah, I'll lick my lips, you know, so I did a lot of this kind of thing. So that was irresponsible in a way, but generally I tried not to make fun of people too.
Well, you used to do.
Because I also think it's a compliment to do so, and I think Barbara Walters probably must have been, in the long run, complimented that somebody would take the time to impersonate them. And often, you know, if it come up that I didn't like the person, I would more often not do them than do them because I didn't want to give them that compliment of taking the time to, you know, learn anything about them and impersonate them.
Well, you used to do Meryl Streep.
Oh, I tried once. Yeah.
And it was on that thing with those farmer guys,
yeah.
In the overalls.
Billy Jim Hurok.
It was Levy and Candy, right?
Yeah, yeah.
You spent a long time with SCTV. You spent a week with Saturday Night Live.
I did not. That was my stupid twin.
Your stupid twin, not your evil twin.
No, my stupid twin.
This is not a guest host shot. This is, in theory, you're a member of the cast, but
yeah.
After a week, you ain't.
I got scared.
Why?
I don't know. I just didn't feel I belonged at that moment, so. Oh, it's terrible. I'm not proud of it. And I wish you hadn't brought it up. It's terrible.
It's a stinging interrogation I'm conducting here, isn't it?
The truth comes out. My Fatty Arbuckle scandal here now. No, I don't know what happened. I went there, and the idea of it sounded good. Oh, doing the same kind of show I did as SCTV, but with an audience and live, and I'll live in New York. Oh, live the high life. And I don't know. I just thought, uh-oh, no, I'm in the wrong place. And I also thought, oh, no, I shouldn't be doing sketches anymore. I should be doing something else. I should be trying to get into movies, anything. And the horrible thing is then I went and did the NBC shows with SCTV right after.
Yeah.
They got that deal together. But Dick Ebersol, who was producing at the time, was very fair-minded about it. He had a press conference, not about me, but about the show and stuff, and they asked him about it, and he was very kind.
So did you look back on it for a long time with regret, or...?
Only... doing that to them, you know, saying I would do something and then saying no, you know, and then turning around saying no, sorry, I'm sorry, I made a mistake, sorry, bye.
So you thought that maybe you should be in movies at that point, When did you break into movies?
Not right then. Because I went and did SCTV, 90-minute shows for NBC. And then I left after they did those, I guess. I don't know if they were still doing them, but I left the show at some point. Yeah, and then, but I left mainly to have a personal life. I was like 25 or something then, and I had no husband and children like I thought I would have by then. So I sort of left show business to start dating.
It's an either-or situation, huh?
Kind of is. Well, I kind of neglected. I realized that, you know, that I'd fallen into this great, you know, job in showbiz, Second City Theater and then SCTV, mm-hmm. but I'd kind of neglected the whole personal life side of life, you know, and most of the people in the cast would go home to families and I would go home to me.
She's hot to go, she's ready, she's hot to go right now. She's hot to go, you got to know, let's stop and do it, girl. She's hot to go, you got to know, let's stop and do it, girl. She's hot to go, she's ready, she's hot to go right now. She's hot to go, you got to know, let's stop and do it, girl.
It turns out that Scorsese was a fan of SCTV, and he gave you your first shot in movies, right?
Yeah. I met him at a film festival in Toronto. They were doing a tribute to him, showing clips from his films and interviewing people mm-hmm. who'd worked with him. And I showed up late, and he was in the lobby. He's standing there waiting to be introduced, and instead of running to be introduced, he ran over to me and introduced himself and said, oh, I love you, I love SCTV. And he went on and on about his favorite skits and couldn't believe it. And said it got him through the editing of Raging Bull, watching tapes of SCTV, And then he ripped out, then he invited my sister and I to dinner with he and Robert De Niro and Harvey Keitel and, you know, mm-hmm. all their friends after the tribute. And then ripped out a piece of paper out of his passport, gave me his phone number and said, call me anytime, you know. Of course, I couldn't think of a good enough reason. Hey, it's me, Catherine. So I just saved it, you know. And then when I went and auditioned for After Hours, he said, you don't still happen to have that piece of paper, do you? Because he was doing location scouting for Last Temptation of Christ, the first time he was going to do it. And they'd stopped him at the border in Tunisia. Like, why is this piece missing, you know? I gave it to some perspiring young actors.
What was Scorsese like to work for?
Oh, amazing. Wish I could work with him again. It was just so exciting and exhilarating, and you're working, like, so hard every minute of the day, but it doesn't feel like work because he keeps you pumped up and he keeps you in character. Never lets you break from character. Keeps you improvising. But he's improvising too, mm-hmm. and he talks to every character like he is that character's best friend, and he treats actors like they are the most precious thing in the world, and everything is about you and your character. And, you know, you can see why people like Joe Pesci and Robert De Niro want to keep working for him, because I'm sure they have never had another director treat them like this. We're just, everything about you in this moment is about what you are feeling, and, you know, the story from your point of view, and he's got such a good, dark, weird, funny sense of humor. I mean, you're laughing all day. It's like intense kind of improvising, but it was really fun because he's laughing. And, like, my character drives, all the characters drive Griffin Dunn nuts, basically get in his way. And I've got him in my loft, and I'm supposed to keep him from leaving. And he's going, like, who's this little effer, you know, with the nerve of him coming in? Well, what do you think? Him coming into your apartment? I'm like, yeah, how dare you? Just sort of getting.
So he's working you up into the mindset.
Yeah, he's like your best friend, your character's best friend, getting you up to it. Just really, like, exciting hard work. You know, you go home wiped out, but you feel, oh, I've done something today. You know?
And now, completely off the page, not just in comparison to Scorsese, but in comparison to anyone, is our friend Tim Burton.
Yeah.
Who did two shows us that were two of the most enjoyable things, and I'm still not sure exactly what he said, but I know I liked it.
Yeah, I watched those shows. They were great. Yeah, that was really fun to watch him with you.
What a truly original guy.
Isn't he?
I mean, you know.
And you have to kind of break your own ideas of conversation and just let yourself absorb what he's saying. And somehow through osmosis or something, you understand him. If you just relax and don't try to make him fit into your way of talking.
It's hard for me to do, like, sound bites, you know? I can never think of anything in less than three words because it would only be, like, or something, you know? It's hard for me to consolidate things.
You're not an ideal subject for entertainment tonight.
No. I'm not sound bite material, really. I can't come up with a clever, quip and, sum up the movie industry in a sentence or anything.
Say, when he's directing, he's sort of just talking about stuff and he's, rubbing his hair and moving his hands and you come away from like, yeah, okay, I know what to do. And you feel like you've come up with it yourself. And I think great directors are great manipulators in a way.
So he gave you a lot of leeway in Beetlejuice?
Yeah, but he also guided us perfectly. I mean, towards what he wanted. You know, so you think that you're coming up with these ideas, but really he's put you there, in a very, on the surface, very loose kind of way. Seems to be just sort of talking to you about things and then you come away with the knowledge of how to do the scene.
I guess if anybody pinpoints any one scene, it's always the Deo scene, right? I mean, that's just hysterically funny. And Dick Cavett sitting there. I mean, just the whole notion Dick Cavett's at your house for dinner.
Oh, and Dick Cavett, who must be, like, the perfect dinner guest because he has several tricks with napkins, tricks with forks, tricks with knives, tricks with wine glasses, a story for every, course.
Right.
It's amazing.
Talk a little literature.
Yeah.
Talk a little movies. Tell you about how he used to know Groucho.
Yeah, he used to.
He's a perfect dinner guest. You're right.
He is, yeah.
On your recent appearance guest hosting Saturday Night Live, there was a bit that you did that you wrote that sounds to me like a funny premise and that just did a swan dive off the high board with the audience.
It
was Halloween night.
Much.
It was Halloween night.
Yeah.
Right? And the idea was these people go to a Halloween party.
Right. This is the morning after.
Right. And one of them's dressed up as Marilyn Monroe.
And the other has a JFK mask.
The other is JFK. Yeah. They wake up and they don't really know who they're with and they're stuck in this.
Right. And when they finally face each other, she wakes up before him and you get the idea from what she says and on the phone with her friend that she doesn't remember anything from the night before. And then she goes in the bathroom to vomit. And then he wakes up and he thinks
always
he's been
robbed. Always a surefire comedy premise, by the way.
Oh, you get those gagging bits in. Oh, excuse me. That kind of always worked. And then he wakes up while she's in the bathroom. So they've never quite confronted each other. And then when they do, they cannot be themselves. They don't have the nerve to be themselves because they know this other person slept with Marilyn Monroe and, she slept with JFK, so they don't want me, They want this, so they maintain their bad impersonations. It seemed like a funny idea, but the audience couldn't see the JFK mask at the beginning for some reason, so they didn't quite understand the premise. And then the ending that we'd cut after dress, the director's great. You know that. He's an amazing director, and he pulls the show off every week, but I think what happened is he didn't turn the page to see the big X's through the rest of the scene, so he didn't put the applause sign on, which is the only way the audience, especially when you die in a scene, the only way they know that it's over.
Right.
And so I closed the door where it was supposed to end for air. I closed the door, and nothing happened. And my first thought was, they put the applause sign on, and in the first time in the history of the show, the audience has refused to applaud. Nope. I don't care, flash it as long as you want. I'm not going to applaud. No, this is really about too low this time. So, and then I waited and I sort of, then I turned around from the door and I tried to look, oh, what a bad date, kind of. And I waited, nothing happened. And then it finally dawned on me, oh, maybe he thinks because of the original ending, I went over to the end of the bed. And I thought, physically, he thinks I'm going to go over there. So physically, I have to show him because I can't say anything. I have to physically remind the director that I'm not going to go over there, so I started sliding my body down the door. But my back was so wet by this point, just a fevered sweat as I wanted to do. And it was like along the door, a wet backslide.
Sort of intermittent suction
was
happening?
Yeah, very nice. Very attractive. Oh, yeah. Just an intense moment of live TV.
A sketch from hell.
Someday I'll learn to laugh at it.
We'd like to thank Catherine O'Hara for stopping by and for wearing these socks for the wide shot.
Yeah.
Home Alone 2 opens this coming Friday, November 20th, and thanks for being with us. See you later.
up later with Martin Short.
Bob Costas, you're quite a guy. I'd say you stand about oh so high. That, whatever the hell else.
Thanks for staying up later. Martin Short makes a return visit. He's Elliot Garfield these days on Broadway in the revival of The Goodbye Girl. Now, as we tape, you have been nominated for the Drama Desk Award and for the Tony Award. But we don't know if you've won or not won.
So no, we don't know.
Let's take it two ways.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Bob. It's good to be a winner.
2, 3, 4. Now, you were robbed. I certainly would have voted for you.
Those guys are hacks. And it's a Hollywood backlash, is what it was. Bob. Is it Bob?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good of you to remember.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
None of this success has gone to your head.
Oh, not at all. Not at all.
This is actually where
you... success it's been.
And this is where you wanted to be, really, for all the SCTV stuff and the year on Saturday Night Live and the movies. I take it that the stage is the thing that you really yearned for when you were a kid.
Well, the first 7 years of my career in Canada as a Canadian actor was always doing stage. And so this is, you know, most actors start off on stage because that's where you get paid the least amount of money. Yeah. Or the less amount of money, as I dramatically like to say. And that's when you have the most fun. Because you do the same thing every night, there's less pressure. You get to perfect a role, but you get to have fun, and the company becomes your friends.
This probably is night in, night out when you go to the theater, especially since the performance has been well received. Less pressure than the creative deadlines of Saturday Night Live or SCTV, where you got to top yourself every week and come up with something new.
Yeah, SCTV was less pressure. That was a lot of pressure, but Saturday Night Live was the most. It was the most intense, you know. Only because you could be a hit on Saturday night, and then it was now Tuesday, and you had no material.
Yeah.
And you felt like a failure.
You knew coming in that you only wanted to do 1 year
right.
on Saturday Night Live.
Right.
Was that because you already had other things planned, or because you had a good understanding that you could only perform at that peak for a year, and then stuff would start to taper off?
I had a good lawyer. 1 year. No, I don't know. It seemed like, what if I didn't like it? Or what if it was, you know, I'd already done SCTV. So those were intense hours. And I now had a little baby girl. And it just seemed like this was something that was going to engulf. I don't know how to do those jobs and just go in, write a sketch, write two sketches, go home and have dinner. I would, you know, if I was told the final sketches had to be in by 6 a.m. on Wednesday morning, I would pace until 3 a.m. Wednesday morning and then type up the sketch. I was like that in school, too. So it was constantly. I never left this building, 30 Rock.
And I saw when you came back in here, as they were miking you up and whatnot, you saw a lot of familiar faces
that
you hadn't seen for a while. It was a happy experience for you.
Absolutely. Oh, no. I mean, I had a ride. Everyone was very nice to me when I did Saturday Night Live. I had no bad experiences that way. But it was just a lot of work, so you kind of felt like you'd done it, and now it's time to do something else.
Is it always a pleasure, or does it bother you a little when people call for characters that you really haven't done for a long time? When they call for Ed Grimley or Jackie Rogers Jr., if you're walking down the street.
Oh, it's great. You know, because it's, first of all, I mean, they're part of me. And secondly, I mean, people wouldn't ask for them if they didn't like them.
You told me, this has to be like 4 years ago, the last time you were on the show, you said you had never met Pat Sajak to
no.
that point. A pretty decent guy, we all must say.
Oh, very decent. Hairdo for days.
Have you met him since?
Still have not met Pat. Padilla. I haven't met him.
He never jotted you a note or told you that he'd seen Grimley's bit?
No, I never, I haven't met him. I hear he's a nice guy, though.
He is a nice guy.
Yeah, very decent guy.
A very decent guy. But isn't that strikes me as odd, that he'd be so central to this
thing. Oh, because he's wrapped up in himself. Well, wait a second.
How did you approach doing Elliot Garfield, where, you know, this is already pretty firmly established, this play and these characters, pretty well established in people's minds. Did that have any effect in the way you worked toward it?
Well, not really, because it's a different medium, you know. I mean, if someone said, hey, do you want to do a remake of The Goodbye Girl as a film,
right.
then you'd be insane, unless the check was good. But to do it as a musical is such a completely different way to do it, that there's no similarity in Richard Dreyfuss's
performance in mind.
Are people surprised that you can sing?
Yeah, they are surprised. They are. You can actually feel it in the audience.
Are you surprised?
No, I'm not surprised. I've been singing for years, Bobby.
See, all I could think of was, give me a C, a bouncy C.
Well, no, that's a different kind of singer. That's a songwriter.
Right, a Brill Building guy.
It worked in the Brill Building. Irving Cohen wrote 1,200 songs a month, all of them dead. If he were here today, he'd say, you know, Bob Costas, you're quite a guy. Give me a C, a bouncy C. Bob Costas, you're quite a guy. I'd say you stand about oh so high. You interview people, and that's a good thing. But then you, and that's not so good. And da da da, whatever the hell else. I'd always been a singer. I used to sing on Canadian talk shows. You know, I'd come on just to sing.
What's the difference between a Canadian talk show, if there is any, and the typical American talk show?
Well, one talk show is seen, and the other isn't. No, actually, it wasn't a talk show. It was a variety show. No, this is a classic. Norm Crosby hosted a show called Everything Goes. And in Canada. It was one of those situations where they were almost going to go with a Canadian rep company, which at that time was Gilda Radner, Danny Aykroyd, Valerie Bromfield, Jane Eastwood, and myself. And at the last second, they panicked because these people weren't well known, so they got an American star, Norm Crosby. And Norm came and did the show, and he was the host of the show, Everything Goes. And I was on every night, and I would come on about once a week and sing, you know, a ballad from Pippin. Or something like, everything has its season. And, you know, I'd suspenders and kind of, and I'd get nervous and dry mouth and forget lyrics. And
Norm would do his usual thing.
Norm said, well, one time, I was on, I followed Tony Bennett. Tony, it was a 90-minute show, and Tony was supposed to be on the first 15 minutes, and I was in the last 15 minutes, but there was a snowstorm, and Tony got there late. So Tony killed with two songs, and then, Mr. Sunshine for me, and they went nuts. And then they, in the middle of his song, they said, you're next. I said, you can't, you know, follow a singer with a singer. And they said, watch. And they set my stool up downstage as Tony was killing upstage. And then Norm Crosby's, you know, Tony finished. And he said, thanks, Tony, that was really good. Now here's a kid who really sings good, Marty Short. And I had to sing, follow Tony Bennett. I was singing You and I, the Stevie Wonder song. And I was so nervous that I not only sang the wrong lyrics, I forgot them, started to make them up, and then inadvertently started to impersonate Tony Bennett. So I was going, here we are. On Earth together, it's you and me. And I'm already wrong, because it's you and I. And I went, our love was made, it was made in heaven. I mean, it's just a disaster. I used to be terrified of forgetting this. But I sang, you know, in these shows all the time. But once you become a satirist, you can't then, you know, come on the Letterman show and sing the score from La Mancha. It doesn't work that way.
Do people tell you that they observe old characters they're familiar with, Ed Grimley here, or Irving Cohen somehow there, in the motions that you make on stage, do they see glimpses of that?
Well, you know, no, I think it is that yes. And I think that what happens is that they're looking for it. They're hoping to see it.
Yeah.
You know? And when I was rehearsing, there's a number that I do in the first act, and Ellie Garfield's really, it's a very energized number. And the choreographer, Graziella Daniel, said, and at one point to you, I think you should come out and you should dance high like this. And I said, if I raise my arms above my shoulders, they'll say it's Ed Grimley doing a, you know. She said, so is that not good? So why don't you be straitjacketed the whole thing? Are you doing Ed Grimley? I said, no. She said, then I don't want this conversation to be had. I said, I don't understand your language, and did it anyway. She was right. You can't be, you know. I can feel the audience if I go, cause you're, and I'm like this, and they're all going, cause they want to see that.
You're living on an Elliot Garfield, Grant. Don't thank me.
Back now with Martin Short, Elliot Garfield these days in the musical version of The Goodbye Girl on Broadway.
At the Marquee Theater, I think, isn't it?
I believe so.
Yeah.
You're not staying at the Marriott Marquee, are you? Just so you can be nearby?
Just on certain nights.
What was it like doing Godspell in Toronto more than 20 years ago?
More than 20 years ago? It was, well, I mean, that was my first job. That was great. And it was this enormously talented cast. Paul Shaffer,
right,
was a piano player. Gilda Radner, and Andrea Martin, and Eugene Levy, Dave Thomas, Victor Garber, Don Scardino. A lot of great, talented people.
Huge percentage of them winding up at SCTV.
Yeah, absolutely.
Is this coincidental, or is there some Canadian comedic sensibility that particularly appeals?
Well, I do think that the Canada, Toronto particularly, I mean, I can only speak for Toronto because that's where I'm from, but the it's at a hub. You know, we would get the pythons before the States got the pythons through BBC. We would get Canadian television, we would get British television, and we would get American television. Mm-hmm. So we were constantly taking in, and that's why SCTV, a show that's, you know, pioneered truly satirizing television that way, it was, in a way, made sense that it would be done in Canada by that group.
Because they're bombarded by so many different...
Yeah, they had so many different places to pull from.
What, if any, character have you ever done where you said afterwards, you saw it played back, man, that is so far over the edge that maybe it's funny, but if I was the person being done here, I'd be really hurt. I couldn't find it in my sense of humor to say, yeah, that's okay.
Whenever you do someone, you have to... I think the gimmick of doing someone, impersonating, is if you have to show that they're good and then show the warts. But you can't just mm-hmm. show the warts. So I can't think that there was anyone that I really thought I was just good old-fashioned being mean. Because, you know, you could control it. In SCTV, where I primarily did pieces like that, you would edit them yourself. And if you looked at it and said, gee, you know, I think that's over the top, you'd alter it. So I don't really think that I did.
Do you have to be, at least to some extent, a fan of everybody you do?
I think to get the voice, to get that person, to understand that person. Sometimes someone would come up and say, gee, can you do Gore Vidal? And you'd want to be on the show. You'd say, sure. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then you'd say to the researcher, give me Gore Vidal tapes, as many as you can get. And then you'd go home and you'd start studying. And for the one take, you'd get Gore Vidal. But generally, if you're doing Jerry Lewis, or if you're doing, I did Robin Williams, I was fans of these people. Mm-hmm. That's how I learned their voices to begin with.
So it was something that you were sort of internalizing even without realizing it, and then when it was time to do it,
watch Jerry Lewis as a kid, and then, gotta get my old tuxedo, now it's time to satirize Jerry, and I know that voice is from my childhood.
So many performers of your generation are really show business savvy, grow up watching television, even if their sensibility seems different than some of the people they may satirize, there's a certain affection for the Jerry Lewis's and the people like that. Now, in Neil Simon, you've got a genuine icon,
right.
Someone you couldn't help but admire, and I would assume you're very familiar with almost everything he had done.
Right.
Did that give you pause before you went into this, wanting to do justice to his work?
Oh, absolutely. But you know what happens is that it's like, I guess, meeting people that you admire on any level or any profession. If you're in a room with Neil, you might be nervous the first time you meet him. Within a very short period of time, he's laughing at something you've done. He's very generous with his laughter. So right away, you've made Neil Simon laugh. And he doesn't just laugh. The glasses come off, the tears, he's going like this.
Yeah.
You know, that happens. So suddenly, he doesn't carry around this legendary thing as much as you yourself do, assuming that he would. So. Within a very short period of time, he's just Mr. Simon.
You fared better than the play in terms of the reviews. Almost everybody liked what you did.
What do you mean almost, Bob?
Everybody. I said almost because I figured someone will fax me something from someplace where someone disagreed. But let's say everybody.
Let's say.
Everybody loved what you did.
Thank you.
Did that make you feel ambivalent going back in, because the play itself had gotten at best mixed reviews, you'd gotten great reviews?
Well, the reality was that actors always say this, I really did not read the reviews.
Come on.
No, I didn't, because the stage is different.
if they say you're brilliant, if they say, you know, that one move and when Martin Short reaches for the vase and it's a magical way he holds his hand, now you got to do it the next night. And so you're trying to be magical and wonderful. So it's better just to stay away from them. I mean, people tell you that they're good or bad. You can't help but get feedback. But I never read specifics. But the show got mixed reviews, but for every, you know, negative review, it got a rave review. So that kind of cancels each other out.
So I just find it hard to believe. You're opening up on Broadway. How could you not grab the papers the next day? Because when it comes to the stage, it's different. The stage is more directly affected by reviews than television
but
or even movies.
But you're going to be told. I'm talking about someone. I'm talking about reading them yourself, as opposed to someone saying, "Well, you know, they're good for you. They're okay for the." I'm talking about generalizations. I don't really, truthfully care about critics. I know it's a cliche. I know, but I used to. Mm-hmm. But I then actually became bored by it because there were too many times where you would read a review and say. Of not something you were in, but something that someone else is in, and say, that guy is nuts. That is a terrible movie. How can he like that movie? So in the next week, if he likes you in a movie, gee, he suddenly got intelligent. I just don't respond to it. I mean, everyone has a right to an opinion, but I just don't. The thing is about reviews is you know yourself. The only time reviews can affect you is if you know you're not very good in something and you're hoping that you won't get caught. But if I do something that I think is really, really good, and some guy who, if I had dinner with, I'd want to take, you know, cyanide capsules, because he'd be that boring, says, oh, I don't think he's that interesting. And you say, have you held a hand mirror recently? This doesn't affect me at all.
Chevy Chase was on a while ago, and conversation got around to the Three Amigos, and he said, that was not as good a movie as it should have been. You share his view?
You know, I don't really talk about these movies because, you know what happens? You end up talking about a movie and it's, again, your opinion. And you've made it, whether you adore it or whether you are in the middle. And meanwhile, the people who have seen that movie or any of the movie that you might dissect later on adore it, and suddenly you're kind of saying to them, you shouldn't have liked it. Mm-hmm. So I think that it's better kept private, post-mortem on movies that you make. You put them, especially comedies, because comedies are so subjective, you put them out there. And I'll tell you about Three Amigos that, certainly more than anything I've done, people come up with the greatest affection and love for that movie, especially kids. So what's perfect? I don't know.
Yeah, I guess especially a comedy, as you say. Yeah. If it makes somebody laugh, that's the end of it. It defies analysis beyond that.
It's amazing. There's such a wide range of reaction to comedy. You know, some people like physical comedy. Some people think it's stupid. Some people like Woody Allen. Some people think it's self-indulgent. Who's right? I don't think anyone's right.
Speaking of physical comedy, the wedding coordinator guy in Father of the Bride.
Wrong, the wedding coordinator.
Yeah, pretty much over the top and back.
What do you mean?
Oh, maybe that's just the way I saw it.
You should have seen the big takes. Yeah, there was some chewed up scenery there.
How much fun was that to do?
Oh, totally, the most fun. Because you see, the thing is about those guys is insane characters. There is no limitation. The only secret, I think, is to do them sincerely. But I mean, I went to a wedding. I actually went to a wedding after I made that movie. And there was a wedding coordinator there. And I thought, I looked at, and I said, Jesus, why didn't I go with those shoes? You know, I mean, you know, it's amazing. You know, you think, you know, that character is broad. Then you go out in life, and it's Perry Como in comparison.
Just as we had two openings, now two closes. Ladies and gentlemen, Tony Award winning, Martin Short.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
And as I said that night, oh, baby.
Don't go away. Our thanks to Tony Award nominee, Martin Short.
Thanks. Damn them and their choices.
But really,
what?
It's the work that counts, not awards.
Not for me.
There you have it. See you later.